Okay. Good afternoon. I'll try that again. Good afternoon and welcome to the 36th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. And I'm delighted to be holding our first external formal meeting of this session in Glasgow today. We're in the Collier Centre in Govan. I've received apologies from David Tollins for today's meeting, and James Dornan will be substituting for him. And we have three of our members are joining us virtually. We've got Tess White, Sandesh Kohani, as well as James, obviously, three additional members, and Carol Mochan. But the rest of us are here in person. It's great to be here. The first item on our agenda today is further consideration of the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And we have two evidence sessions and two panels. So I'll welcome our first panel. We've got Claire Gallagher, who's a Human Rights Officer for the Council of Ethnic Minority Voluntary Sector Organisations in Scotland. We've got Hannah Tweed, the Senior Policy Officer for Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, or the Alliance. We've got John Williamson, the Chief Executive of Share Care Scotland. We've got Barry Wiley, the Chief Officer for Highland Third Sector Interface and TSA Scotland Network. And joining us online, we've got Karen Sheridan, the Chief Operating Officer for Community Integrated Care. So welcome to you all. I'm going to hand over to my colleague Sandesh Kohani for the first question. Sandesh. He looks like he may have frozen. Oh, no. Sandesh, can you hear me? I'm not sure if Sandesh is hearing me. We'll try again. Maybe until Sandesh gets organised, what I can do is I can just ask the panel. The bill has arisen largely out of the Independent Review on Adult Social Care, also known as the Feely Report. We've had Derek Feely in front of us to talk about his thoughts on the draft bill in front of us. I'd like to ask all of you your views on whether or not the bill as introduced accurately reflects the recommendations of the review, and if you feel that any key recommendations from the review are missing. And if I maybe go to Barry first of all. You don't have to operate your microphone, it's done thank for you.
Thank you for having us as well today. By and large, we think it probably is heading in the right direction, but most of the feedback that we've got is really concerned about what will be the practical application within the bill. So at this stage, generally there's support that it probably is responding to in terms of the adult social care aspects to it from within our membership, but that there are not concerns necessarily, but there is a very strong interest in what will that look like in the practical terms as the bill develops in detail. I think in relation to the community justice side and the children's side, there's probably some questions in terms of where do they fit in the absence of something that's equivalent to the Feely Report in connection with those services, if that makes sense.
It does. And if I go to Hannah next.
We would have a broadly similar position from within our membership, I think. The phrase that we've been using to summarise has been conditional optimism, in that few would argue with the principles, but the practice and the detail of what is and isn't included in the bill is open to some concern and some questions. More on that, I imagine, as the session continues.
Let's develop it. I mean, what aspects do you think that you would like to have seen on the face of the bill that you think aren't already there and that maybe can't wait until the co-design process?
Yep. So, two things that aren't there at all, and that are major areas of concern, would be care charging and eligibility criteria as key things that affect people's access to social care and to appropriate ability to live independently and well. And I think we've heard that again and again, that those are really mattering on the ground to people, and they're not explicitly engaged with within the bill in its current format. We would also have a range of areas such as it's really welcome that care boards mention engagement with people with lived experience. There's nothing in there to ensure that that is a prerequisite in order for decisions to be correct. And consultation is not the same thing we would consider as engagement in decision making. So seeing that kind of detail in primary legislation to ensure that those very welcome mentions of human rights-based approaches in the opening section one, I think that further detail needed at this stage, and then the T's and C's in regulation following co-production would be the kind of thing we were looking for. I mean, I can literally run through the full bill, but that might take longer.
But that's very helpful, even as a starting point. So I'll go to John next.
Yeah, I mean, very similar comments. We're very supportive of the legislation and the development of a national care service. We agree with the intent behind it, that we need to improve the quality and consistency of community health and social care services across Scotland, ending the postcode lottery. We also agree that the effective delivery of human rights should be at the core of this new national care service. However, I think, like colleagues, this is framework legislation, so it's actually been quite difficult to engage with our members and stakeholders to discuss in detail how this national care service will actually work in practice. So it's actually quite difficult, I think, and our sort of main constituency are unpaid carers and the people that they support. So it's actually been quite difficult for them to come to a clear view on just how this will work in practice, because they don't know how the structures are going to develop. They don't know how the human rights principles will actually be applied in practice, and they don't know how they and the people that they support will be meaningfully engaged in the development of those systems and structures. So I think, you know, it's been quite challenging to engage people in that level of detail when we simply don't have that information on the face of the legislation. So I think that the expression that we've heard used is that people are cautiously supportive of the legislation, but there's clearly a lot of information yet still to come that they would like to get, just more detail of.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dawn. Claire.
Hi. I think I'm much the same as the rest of the panel, that it seems to be heading in the right direction, but it's the practical part and the practical element that people are struggling with and that we're struggling with to understand what impact it's going to have, how is it going to improve things in adult social care. I think I like the inclusion of human rights, mention of human rights, mention of a human rights-based approach. I think that's a welcome thing to do, but what I struggle to see how that would be impactful in practice when we don't have key human rights principles in the primary legislation. So there's no mention of dignity within the legislation. And I think that's really important. We've done it in past legislation with Social Security Scotland, self-directed support. I think that's a core part of human rights law. It tells us why we have our human rights, but not having it in our safety net, in our law, to have meaningful impact and a human rights-based approach. If we don't have that in our law, then it's going to be really, really difficult.
But as if that doesn't have to wait for a co-design process to have brought that brought
that
out, because it's already in existing, yes.
And the other thing, it should be at the very beginning, not retrospective. It should be at the heart, and that's why it should be at primary legislation level and not secondary. And I think also having mentioning specific human rights, what the bill will impact on, so private and family life, attainable high sustainable standard of mental and physical health, those should all be explicitly referenced in the primary legislation as well, like previous legislations have done. And those legislations, I think there's a lot to be learned from, just from the legislation part, because they've been recognised around the world as really progressive in terms of human rights implementation legislation. So I think that's something that the bill could do just now in the first instance before it goes out to co-design.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'll go online and ask Karen for her initial reflections on the review and the bill and how they work together or not.
Thanks. I think broadly we are welcoming the National Care Service in the bill. I think like others, there's some gaps that we would like to see as we go through to the co-design stage. You know, principally, you know, around, you know, how do we involve, make sure everybody's involved in this, so that real human voice of people who use services those that care for them, and also, you know, for me as a representative from the voluntary sector just now. The bill in its current format we feel is very structural and doesn't include the significant cultural change that will be required for the National Care Service to be effective. We're really pleased to see the references to human rights, especially in terms of prevention and empowerment for individuals. But how do we work towards that through that co-design stage? I think for us, some of the bits we thought it lacked some clarity was, you know, between the charter and the principles. And there wasn't much reference to the importance of self-directed support in the health and social care standards as they currently fit just now. Of course, they can all be clarified once we get into that co-design stage. And I think probably lastly for us is, you know, around, you know, the funding and how the National Care Service would be developed within the financial envelope that was within the financial memorandum as well, because it feels exceptionally light for the size of the task that we would have going forward. But I think broadly, you know, support of the direction of the National Care Service, but we'd like to see more of that cultural-based work that will be required in line with the Feely report as that was published.
Thank you, and that's a really helpful start for us. I'll now, I think I can bring in Sandesh. Can you hear me now, Sandesh?
I can now, yes.
Excellent, on you go.
Thank you. So my question, much of the panel highlighted a lack of detail. I think we're hearing a little bit of that already from the last question that I heard. I'm afraid I didn't hear all your answers. So I wonder if we could maybe start with Hannah Tweed. If you could maybe highlight any specific areas the government needs to come forward on and provide more detail when it comes to the bill itself.
Yep, absolutely. So I mentioned that I'd like to see, that the Alliance and our membership were in broad agreement that we'd like to see more details on care board representation at primary legislative level to ensure proper participation in decision making. That also threads through a number of other elements. So, for example, in Section 7, with strategic planning by Scottish ministers and by care boards, there's commitment to, we would like to see a commitment to more than just public consultation, but to co-production, seeing that involvement in decision making again stipulated in primary legislation. And that also needs to come alongside wider data collection duties, which are mentioned as something that is, again, very welcome, but there's no obligation to do so. And if I can put it in these terms, you don't know what you don't know, because if you don't have the detailed data collection to evidence things like unmet need and where the gaps are in terms of people not receiving equitable access to social care, which we know some of from pre-existing research, but it's not part of our routine data collection and analysis in terms of an intersectional analysis. So we'd like to see more of that made as a prerequisite. There was also quite a lot of concern around the role of the third and independent sector within the primary legislation. So at the moment, please correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is the definition of sort of strategic partners is more engaged with local authority delivery and with health and social care partnership delivery of social care, which, given the really significant role of the third sector and of volunteers within providing health and social care services and support to people, seems like a pretty significant omission, particularly in those wider planning processes as a key partner. So that's something that in, say, Section 8, we would like to see the third and independent sectors mentioned as community planning partners and involved in that process. We've also got questions about the mention of ethical commissioning of independent advocacy. Again, very welcome. Great. Definitions of what that means we feel would be really useful to see in primary legislation. And I know that social security legislation caused some headaches around that with independent advocacy, but we think there's learning to be drawn on from that to enable the going back to Gary's point about implementation, to when we reach that stage, to enable people to go, yep, we understand what is meant by independent advocacy exactly, and we understand therefore how to properly resource it and commission it and to ensure it's available to people on the ground. And if we have that definition within primary legislation, it enables regulation and guidance to be much more robust, and therefore the implementation to be much more meaningful and easier albeit with some sweating from the legal team in the meantime. We also had some concerns about the Charter of Rights and Responsibilities, great in terms of putting human rights at the forefront, as with earlier comments. What happens if the principles of that charter aren't met? It's not clear at the moment in the framework bill what gives that teeth, if I can put it bluntly. Because if you have rights, deliver them and people don't have redress, that's going to cause problems. And I think that would be contrary to the intentions of the bill and to the intentions of what the National Care Service is proposing to do. So again, that's something we would like to see further detail on, so that it is really clear how things will be delivered in practice. Now, that doesn't mean the fine T's and C's. I can see why that waits for regulation. We also had concerns around the care record section in Section 36, specifically around citizen access to records. So it is not only health and social care professionals with access to records, and control of, and that would again be in line with human rights digital principles. And that's also something, again, we would like to see third sector access to where appropriate and with permission of the individual. Those are some of the sort of key areas.
And my colleagues will be dipping into quite a lot of that, and you'll have asked specific questions around that. Sandesh, I believe you have one more question before we move on.
I do, thank you. And Hannah, thank you for that detail. It's to Don Williamson. And I do want to sort of touch upon BAME carers. It's obviously a topic which I find particularly important and think we need to do a bit more on. But it seems that only 3% of unpaid carers are able to access paid breaks. Why is that? And what are the main barriers to stop carers from accessing these breaks?
Thank you. So the 3% figure is a Scottish Government figure, and that's the number of carers who are accessing breaks with the help of statutory support. And obviously that's an incredibly low figure, given that we know that access to breaks is reported by carers as being, you know, fundamentally important to you know, promoting their health and well-being. I think the question as to why is it so little at the moment is the big question. I think that we need to gain a much sort of deeper understanding of why that is. I think what carers report to us is that there just simply isn't enough suitable provision available to access at the moment. They report that it is incredibly complex and bureaucratic systems that are needed to be navigated in order to even get to the point where they might be deemed eligible to receive a break from caring. There is, of course, the eligibility criteria that's being applied as well, which is sort of generally set at the point of being, you know, you have to be at a breaking point or in critical need before you're able to receive that statutory support in order to be able to access a break. I mean, many carers will tell you that they have just never been had a discussion with anybody about the fact that they may be entitled to receive a break from caring. That's never been discussed with them, so therefore they just don't know that might be a possibility. So I mean, there are many reasons, and I think I think we'll come on to the topic, I think, perhaps later in terms of the right to a break, but it's our main concern about the meaningful implementation of a right to a break is that it is completely, you know, contingent on there being sufficient availability of short breaks provision for carers. Carers will tell us that it's rather meaningless to have a right to a break if there just isn't the range and choice and volume of provision available to them.
Thank you. And now to questions from Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, convener, and good afternoon to the panel. I think it was a useful opening in terms of general principles of the bill, but I wonder if we can look at what's actually in the bill, in the sense that the bill provides for the transfer of accountability from local authorities to Scottish ministers. And I suppose I'm keen to maybe start with that concept and ask for your view on that, and indeed what are the, I suppose, the risks and the benefits therein. So if I can maybe start with Mari, if that's possible.
Yeah,
Yeah, so we have touched on that with some of our members as part of the response initially. Generally, my impression is that they believe there would be more transparency if it was that the services were accountable to ministers. I think that probably stems from a lack of frustration around the lack of transparency at a local level or perceived lack of transparency. So generally speaking, I would say that people seem reasonably open to that as in the pathway of accountability, but there are significant questions around what does the governance look like in general? How would that then have an impact at a local level? What are the structures that we're intent on managing that pathway of governance and accountability through? So whilst there is general support, I think there are more questions than there appear to be answers from individuals we've spoken to. Outside of that, just growing that pathway through, I think the general impression that we're also getting is that the ministers may be more willing to honour a more equitable partnership of representation from across various carers, users, third sector, in a way that is not a simple tick box experience, as in that we often get invited to attend meetings, but our ability to influence policy or decision making is very, very limited. And the only instance that I can recall where we've ever had the direct ability to approve budgetary spend was actually in reshaping care for older people about 8-9 years ago, where the spend couldn't be done until the third sector signed that off. So I think that by and large, there is cautious optimism, as my colleagues have said, a feeling that there is an opportunity for more transparency, but how much of that derives from the bill and how much of that derives from optimism around the concept that change can only possibly make things better, I couldn't say.
Yeah, well, I wonder if I can just, from a Highland perspective, was there any sense from the people you consulted with in terms of your membership that things are already perhaps feel further away from communities? Was there a sense that there was a need to bring things closer to communities? I wonder if we tie that to the proposal for care boards. Did people want to see care boards that were more local rather than just necessarily being in Inverness or whatever?
So that was an area of concern, was because there wasn't an awful lot of information within the bill, what did we potentially mean by geography of a care board? So that did come up. As I'm sure you're very much aware, Highland is the equivalent size of Belgium. So the concept that there is a homogenous Highland view is often misleading. And in actual fact, I think people would be really welcoming of the idea of having much more local care boards that were answerable to a ministerial arrangement, rather than necessarily seeing themselves, I suppose, seeing the care board sat at a regional level. The biggest concern, though, wasn't so much that they would move, or rather the biggest concern was that it would move to an NHS board level, which in Highland isn't necessarily a massive change. It would just see Argyll and Bute, but for some other areas of Scotland, that would be quite a significant change from an accountability perspective. So I think people would be more welcoming of a more local approach. And I would, if I can, I think that that's one of the reasons that particularly needs to be thought through, is because we talk about within the bill about people having equity of service. I think we need to talk about equity of outcome, because actually, what we get in terms of achieving an outcome, that might look very different, the activities and actions that need to take place to achieve that outcome, whether you're in Portree or whether you're in Dumfries. And actually, we need that flexibility, so I think we've got to be really careful about that. But local would be better. Obviously, we would say that from Highland, though.
Thank you. Hannah, did I see you want to come in? No? No?
Done.
I'll come to Claire and then Hannah.
Yeah, I think just to build on the transfer of accountability, I think what it requires is a bit more of assurance about what that's going to look like. So from our point of view, we had to start way back at scratch and develop knowledge and understanding of care services. And that might sound a bit out of touch of what we're here for today, but I think the transfer of services, what we have to ensure, that whether it be the accountable body, be a care board geographically or whatever accountable body it may be, that design of that board and the way that they deliver service and they design service has to have a human rights-based approach and anti-racism in the heart of it at the very beginning. So that means things like having training. We talked about staff culture earlier on. because quite frankly, the organisations that we work with, people are saying that it's not going to change their view, because people from ethnic minority communities, when we've been engaging them with other areas of social care, like for example the older person's strategy, it's that, well, we can't access the care in the first place because the access to translators isn't viable. We can't, we don't know what we're, that we could access care in the first place. Somebody said that they would rather call a third sector organisation that supports them rather than 999 because of the translation barrier. And I think having that and building on that trust, we know that that trust isn't there just now within local authorities, and it isn't there at government level. So this is a really good opportunity to recognise that and address the barriers of trust and institutional racism, and make sure that that is at the heart in everything that you do within the new accountable body.
Can I bring in Hannah?
Yeah, we would echo much of that. I think what has come through loud and clear hearing from our membership is the need for people who have problems accessing services or problems with the delivery of service, including the workforce, so I'm not just talking about people accessing SDS or social care, need to have trust in the system of redress and of raising concerns and complaints. And I'm not sure that that consistently happens at the moment across Scotland. Quite the contrary, actually. That's partially because we have different systems for people to access support, for them to seek information. Some of that is quite opaque. It's difficult to navigate. That causes problems for specific population groups for whom, you know, specific examples my colleague Claire has just highlighted. But, you know, others we've heard from people with learning disabilities, although I suspect Andy in the next panel will speak more about that, around how accessible and inclusive the communication is around accountability processes for individuals on the ground, or and problems with that. Part of me says, from an efficiency point of view, if you're approaching accessibility and inclusivity, if that communication is all coming to a centralised body, at least it's been, you know, worked up to a suitable standard in one instance, although still wanting to engage with local concerns, as highlighted by Vary. I think the other thing that's key part of that is working through what does ministerial responsibility mean, and how do we ensure that people can maintain trust in that. So things that I would highlight there would be, in the event of an emergency intervention, which, don't ask me which section that is, two-thirds of the way through the bill, if that is necessary, is there also a duty there that ministers will have that as time-limited as possible? Is there a duty that they will pay due attention to the principles outlined in the Charter? I mean, I would believe that that would be implicit, but implicit is not the same as explicit in legislation, to ensure that there's a real front and centre prioritisation of those accountability structures within any redesign. Yeah.
I wonder if I can just follow up that point. Would it be the Alliance's contention then that something that is essentially in the control of ministers and accountable to Parliament, to 128 of us, that would be more accountable for people than perhaps the local authority? Am I right in terms of that was your initial response there?
I think that we have concerns that we're aware of at the moment that complaint systems involve a bit of marking your own homework, because there isn't the independent distance. So the people to whom you raise concerns, maybe the people who decide whether your third sector organisation gets funding, or there may be the person who decide whether or not your SDS package gets cut next time you have an assessment. And that comes with fear, understandably so. If you have a more removed structure, or an independent structure where the people are not making direct decisions on things that, I mean, ministers obviously make decisions on things that affect people's lives, but in a slightly less immediate sense than you're about to lose a third of your SDS budget. There's greater potential there. I think that may also relate to your point about current problems with distrust with the current system as much as anything else. You're in that case being a colleague to the right.
So by logic, because I think we're probably talking about people who would be seen as gatekeepers in this, with social work, probably, amongst others, as commissioners. So it would be better for them to sit with a more national body than locally?
I do not want to criticise individual social workers, many of whom I know, you know, the vast majority of whom are working flat out to try and get the best outcomes for folk. But there is real value in an independent body who is ensuring accountability.
Okay.
Can I just on that single point?
Sorry. It's just, I think, yes, it would be better to have a bit of a break between the organisation that is ultimately commissioning services, regardless of whether they are within the public sector, the private sector, or third sector, and the individuals who are then delivering the services themselves, including, I would add, the third sector. So when we think about representation from users and carers in third sectors within those decision-making bodies, we've got to do that very carefully and cleverly, because we have seen evidence. I'm not criticising any individual social workers. I would agree with the comments that were made. But realistically, when you're passionate about an area of work that you're undertaking, it's how is your ability to step back and look at the strategic picture and make a genuine decision about where the best use of the resources to go. And we often come against specific views and perspectives of third sector services within those commissioning frameworks that are not necessarily justified, and they're made from individuals who are very much involved in almost a competitive element of that they provide services through a different route and avenue, and yet they're actively involved in making decisions about what will be commissioned elsewhere within the private and third sector, and you can't possibly in any framework imagine that that's done so unbiasedly.
John wanted to come in, and then I'll move on to the next theme.
I think it was just to say that one of the reasons I think that people are looking for some kind of radical change is that the current system isn't working and there isn't that accountability that people might have expected. So we have a situation where we have good national legislation that, you know, should be driving forward improvements. I mean, a good example of that would be self-directed support legislation. But carers becoming and supported people becoming increasingly frustrated at the fact you have national legislation but it's not being implemented consistently locally. And there doesn't seem to be that sort of accountability. So, you know, you have national legislation developed by government through Scottish Parliament, but it's the responsibility of local authorities, IGBs, health and social care partnerships to implement it, but there just doesn't appear to be that accountability, and there doesn't seem the carers are feeling, you know, frustrated that they don't seem to have any means of redress when their rights or what they might expect to flow from that legislation isn't materialising. So I think part of the frustration here is that people are saying if the current system isn't working, we need to change it. And if this is the radical change that we need in order to kind of create that accountability and so that we can exercise, we can have rights and we can exercise those rights, then this is what people would like to see happen. But I think it is born out of a frustration that things just aren't working for them at the moment and there isn't that accountability.
Thank you. Can I go to James Thorne, who wants to ask some questions about Anne's Law? James.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose I'd like to ask maybe Hannah first about the bill as it's introduced and the concerns of carers about care home visits. How could you see this section of the bill be amended to address these concerns?
Sorry, would you be able to repeat that? I lost you midway through.
Yes, no more. Do you believe that the bill as introduced addresses the concerns of carers with regards to care home visits? And if not, how would you see this section of the bill be amended to address those concerns?
I think that Anne's Law is very welcome, would be my first statement. And I think that's there's probably broad agreement across our membership that, you know, prioritising people's right to family life, right to live well, by saying that includes viewing residential care homes as homes, and so people have everything else you would expect to have as part of your right, your home within that, he's welcome. We think that this section could be more explicit in referencing existing human rights treaties to reinforce that. So Article 26, Habilitation and Rehabilitation, is the one that springs to mind. In terms of addressing carers' concerns, I mean, I would I would honestly be inclined to defer to my colleague Don for that, given relative specialisms. But what we did think was that this is an area where really extensive co-production would be really valuable and essential in terms of seeing that implementation in practice element properly worked up. And I think that that's also worth considering in terms of how is the learning from the COVID-19 pandemic being drawn upon to inform the practicalities of that. So making sure that that's a key priority within follow-through commissioning processes to ensure that, you know, systems are in place to enable proper visitation and proper right to family engagement and community engagement.
Since you've been mentioned, and
tag your hat.
Yeah, thanks. Sorry about that.
Don't worry about it.
I think just we are, I mean, certainly supportive of that of this new right. I think family carers are there and complement the care that's provided by care home staff, and they provide, you know, essential social and emotional support to complement that care. And we know that as carers were denied access to their loved ones due to the pandemic, that caused enormous distress and anxiety. So I think we are fully supportive of this new right.
Can we have James Dorman's mic
option
live? James, you're going to have to say that again because your mic wasn't unmuted. So if you can again,
my apologies.
It's not your fault.
Given the comments that Hannah made previously, then would you agree that this was a good opportunity for to show the benefits of that co-design and co-production after the framework bill has been agreed?
I have. I'm unlikely to have an objection to co-production, so I can definitely see value in that. Yes, I think the other area where this could also be expanded, and perhaps should have answered in previous answer, is we would also be supporting calls from Chest Heart Stroke Scotland and other colleagues to include in this section or in others a right to rehabilitation as something that aligns very closely. Specifically around ensuring independent living and in the Article 26 of the UN CRPD, got that in the right order, to further flesh out that section, particularly in providing definitions around primary healthcare and social care and sort of transitions between the two. And I think also just building on the comments about unpaid carers that Don was making, the other thing we've heard through various research projects we've done is the real value where health boards and where care homes do enable, say, personal assistance, people who have been long-term supporters of individuals with an SDS package or SDS arrangements, being able to provide support in hospital formats and in residential care, particularly in sort of cases of, say, 6 weeks rehabilitation from hospital to home via residential care, that sort of situation. The real value of having people who understand people's communication needs, who understand their preferences, what they want, you know, will and preference, where that can be accommodated, that has such good outcomes for people. It's absolutely in line with existing legislation. And I think would be really important to see prioritised through the existing planning. It doesn't happen consistently. You know, we hear a lot of instances where, as with family carers, personal assistants and care workers are not given that access, even when it is the desire of the individual accessing services. So ensuring that right to rehabilitation, all the T's and C's of that therein are included would be most welcome. James, do you have anything further?
No, I'll leave it like that. I might come back in later.
I just want to follow up. I mean, I think it comes back to what you're saying about the charter having teeth. I mean, you've already mentioned some other human rights legislation that you think is actually the backdrop for quite a lot of those rights that weren't met. So, I'm doing that thing of making a comment rather than a question, but I would just ask for your reflections on that, because there's already legislation out there that people haven't felt that their rights have been met. Then the Charter and the National Care Service Bill has to have something in it, presumably, that allows people that avenue to question when their rights haven't been met. Hannah?
Yes.
Yes, I know. I know. I've got to remember sometimes that I'm meant to be asking questions rather than. But I'll bring in Vali. You wanted to come in, Vali.
It's really. All of our members that we spoke to around us were very welcoming of that aspect in terms of right to access within care homes. But there's a practical side of that when you start to get into remote, rural, and even islands. You know, we have individuals who, quite frankly, can't get to their family using public transport, because public transport just doesn't, it does not go there first and foremost, and it certainly doesn't go there and back again in the same day. So I think there's an element whereby when we talk about access and that right to family life, we've got to understand that the interdependencies within that are far more than simply a question of opening a door and welcoming people in. It's actually about allowing people to get from point A to point B in the first place and making that reasonable and affordable. And that's one of the biggest aspects, particularly when we get into remote and rural areas, is the practical elements of getting to our loved ones can actually be incredibly significant barriers, not just in terms of being able to try and continue that continuity of family life once somebody is in a care setting, but also in reference to rehabilitation too. And that continuity of care and carers as well is a significant issue.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from Emma Harper. Emma.
Convener, good afternoon, everybody. We've touched already, Dawn, you talked about unpaid carers and how do we support them. And this bill actually has information to suggest amendments to the Carer Scotland Act in respect of rights for breaks for carers, amending subsections 2 to 10. And you were talking about eligibility criteria and the language that is so there's suggestions about changing that, I suppose, to make it more easier for unpaid carers to obtain or access breaks. And some of the language, it is interesting, it is all very legal language. And when you start picking it apart, you talk about this in subsection, changing the words eligible needs and substitute it for relevant needs that meet the local eligibility criteria. So it is, it's like, so okay, so now we have to think about going back to looking at, well, what is the eligibility criteria? And then how do we get breaks for unpaid carers? And breaks aren't the be-all and end-all, because some of the care is so complicated that you actually maybe need one or two registered nurses to be able to be trained to deliver some care that a parent is delivering already. So just wondering about your thoughts about the language in the bill to support breaks for carers, and then if that language is adequate, and then I suppose down the line that's something that we really need to support and help, is the work that unpaid carers do needs to really be valued, and then how do we get them the best support, whether it's respite breaks or that in the language of the bill as well. I'll go to Dawn first, since you're the one that picked that up when Sandesh asked the question.
Okay, thank you. Well, thank you for the question. So the bill proposes amendments, as you say, to the current Care Scotland Act 2016 to provide rights for assessed carers, this includes adult and young carers, to have sufficient breaks from caring. And I think the term sufficient, we can talk about that and how that's interpreted. And the bill also clarifies, as far as our understanding of it, that eligibility criteria in determining whether this right can be applied or not is removed from those kind of decisions. So we're now taking eligibility criteria out of the determination as to whether a carer has a right to a break or not. So that's, we see that as a very positive, a positive development. But in order for that right to be effective and meaningful, it has to be clearly defined. I think that's the most important thing. It has to be understandable and it has to be measurable. And so we are concerned about how that term, sufficient breaks from caring, might be interpreted. And I think also, in order for it to be deliverable, there needs to be sufficient supply of short break services and support locally to meet the needs of all carers who would have this right. And again, we have some concerns about that too. So in terms of the first point about the interpretation of the term sufficient, this lack of a clear definition on the face of the legislation is of real concern to us at the moment. Clearly, having a clear definition of what sufficient actually means will strengthen the position of the right holders of unpaid carers. And it will give them a level of accountability, and it will provide scrutiny to that term. And I think most importantly, avoids the potential situation of carers finding themselves in some kind of dispute with local authorities or care boards who will eventually take on responsibility for this about, you know, whether they're getting sufficient breaks from caring or not. I mean, sufficient can be looked at in a number of different ways. Is it sufficient breaks to stop a carer just going over the edge and you know, reaching breaking point? Or is it sufficient to enable the carer to have good health and well-being and to live the best life that they can? It could be interpreted in either of those ways or something in between. So we think it's really important that this term is properly defined. And I think in the absence of a clear definition, there's always the possibility that it becomes a proxy form of eligibility criteria, which is what we're trying to avoid, and is what the government has said that they want to take eligibility criteria out of this particular issue.
And sufficient for one person might not be sufficient for another, so it's all very person-centred,
yes,
to use that word. And I suppose breaks might also be a break with the person you're caring for. So does that language need to be in the bill? I mean, how do we define that, or can that be worked upon? Okay, we know the bill says, yeah, let's look at sufficiency, let's look at non-eligible language, let's mean that the overarching framework means that then we can build upon that language and then have the clarifying language that defines what sufficient is, and build on that through an approach that is taking the person's views on board. Is that would be part of the co-production, would it?
Well, yes. I think your point about personalisation is really key to this, is that we have, within statutory guidance, we have a good sort of definition of what a short break should how it could be defined, and this is in the context of the Carers Act as we have it at the moment, but we're still seeing that being inconsistently applied. So, you know, we do encounter situations where carers feel that their outcomes for a break would best be met by having a break with the cared for person, but that's being denied to them because it's felt that that isn't a break from the caring responsibility, but it's a break from the person's routine, and it provides, you know, an important way to get away from the sort of daily routines of, you know, being a carer, but with the person that they care for. So that would, you know, should be entirely acceptable, and should be entirely acceptable. The concern, I think, at the moment in the language as it stands within the bill is that it proposes to amend the Carer Scotland Act to ensure that carers get the support that they need to take sufficient breaks from providing care to the cared for persons. And I think we're just a wee bit concerned that what that might suggest is it sort of excludes the possibility of people, you know, choosing to have a break together or having a break in any way that they feel is appropriate to meet their outcomes.
So that might be too prescriptive in that case, that bit of language
reading
there.
Of that, yeah.
And because breaks it's about young carers caring for other people, it's also about older people caring for their spouses. It's huge what happens in health and social out there in social care.
It is huge, but existing legislation, self-directed support, should give people that control and flexibility over how their outcomes should be met. And the right to a break should be reinforcing that.
Okay.
That personalisation and that choice, because carers and the people that they support are in a far better position to know what is the best way or the best means by which they can have their outcomes met.
Okay. Yeah, and I was going to suggest that, you know, it's obviously carers and breaks it's like three pages of this bill, so it's something that we really need to think about, and happy to hear any suggestions for improvements.
I mean, the line that Don outlined in 38.2.1 is also underlined in my copy as enabling people to take breaks with family if that is what they deem is appropriate is really important.
There's also something there about the need for proactive commissioning of services in places where there is just not sufficient provision. But I think also there's something about referring back to the new standard 12 within the standards for good SDS around finance and flexibility, because I think the language of that really draws out what we're outlining there around person-centred choices, that as long as something meets people's outcomes, they should be able to spend relevant money appropriately. I mean, obviously in line with existing legislation, I'm not suggesting otherwise, but if the best thing is for a short break for the family to go away, grand. Shouldn't need to be separate, shouldn't need to be on a prescribed list of you can only use these providers, shouldn't be tied to, Shared Care Scotland does amazing work with short breaks. It shouldn't be the only route. That's certainly not no criticism of that provision, but to allow that flexibility and to allow it in legislation while also in framing that every carer should have the right to breaks and not and making sure that is not linked to things like carer's allowance. So we end up with that 3% figure. So it's really, really clear that this is a universal right.
Don?
Yeah, just to come back to the second point, as well as that clear interpretation, so there's no sort of ambiguous language around sufficiency. I think it's really important to recognise, and carers have told us this repeatedly, and I guess most recently at the Carers Parliament last month, is that there is a right to a break is rather meaningless if there isn't the provision available for people to be able to, have a break. And a lot of that provision is about replacement care, so that carers can actually, if they choose to have a break apart, is that they can choose to do that because there is somebody able to come in and substitute for that care. Or care to go with the person that they care for to have a break, so they can have a break together with some extra care in place. So the bill itself doesn't, even though the Feely recommended that, as well as the right to break, there should also be, there was also the need to develop a range of options for respite and short breaks. The bill itself doesn't seem to address or provide any kind of investment strategy for how we're going to actually, improve the availability of provision and make sure that the provision is the right provision for carers. And I think this is an area that really has been under-researched. There is real concern, within the sector, and much of this provision is being delivered by the third and independent sector, that they are really struggling at the moment because of all the sort of known economic pressures, cost of living, inflationary pressures, workforce issues, and so on. So I think if this right to a break is to be effective and meaningful, there is a lot of work that needs to be done to actually understand what is the current status of our short breaks infrastructure at the moment, and what needs to be done by way of investment to try and bring things up to a level that this break can actually be achieved.
Emma, I just conscious of the fact that Karen wanted to come in, but I think it might have been on my previous point around Anne's law, but can I just check in with Karen to see if that's the case or whether she's got anything to add in relation to the questions that you've been asking, Karen?
Yeah, thank you. It was specifically around Anne's law, and it's very brief. I think it's really welcome to see it within the bill, but as a provider for independent living, people who live within supported living settings, we would welcome the extension to recognise those visiting rights for those who don't live in residential settings, because through the pandemic we've seen the same restrictions and same inconsistencies being applied to individuals who lived either in their own home or in a shared tenancy with somebody else. And it is really important, it's so vital for their health and wellbeing to have that same access. So we would welcome it being extended beyond a residential care home setting for individuals.
Thank you, Karen, and apologies for not coming to you at the time. I didn't realise that you'd asked to come in. Emma, did you have one final part, and then I'll need to move on?
Yeah, so one of our questions in our briefing paper, it would be directly about minority ethnic carers as well. So I think we need to make sure the questions are representative of that as well. So basically, the direct question is about what additional needs and potential barriers should be considered in relation to carers from minority ethnic communities with respect to access to breaks.
one of the biggest things that we've came across while doing engagement work around unpaid carers is that term. It is not recognisable. People don't see themselves, and it's not limited to the ethnic minority communities, but it's definitely more prevalent that they don't see themselves as unpaid carers, because it's your job to look after a loved one or a close family friend. So I think we need to break down. We ourselves learned we had to break that down when we were doing consultation events to say, right, this means, are you a person who provides care for a child with additional support needs, a family member? And I think that's the first step in addressing that barrier. So I would agree with the comments that Dawn has made about being explicit in what the right to a break means, but also you have to take into consideration that when we're talking about implementation of what a right to a break means, we need to take a step back and realise that ethnic minority communities do not access social care as much as other communities, because there is a huge barriers with trust. Language barriers is a huge issue. Care homes is the food culturally appropriate? Do staff speak the right language? Some people say that you can get translators in, but at 3 a.m. when you've had a fall in a care home, you don't get a translator. Three-way translation calls are really, really difficult. And if you're elderly, that becomes even more difficult to track what's going on. And I think what we found quite profound was that when we were doing one of our engagement sessions around the older person strategy, was that a lady who cared for her dad knew that eventually she would require other support because of medical needs, but she had no idea where would you even go to get that. So I think we have to take a step back and realise that for equitable outcomes, if groups in society need different support to get to that outcome. And one of the big things is recognising that ethnic minority communities do not access social care support the exact same way due to things around trust, language, institutional racism within the system, but then also workforce diversity is really important. So I think all of that needs to be taken into consideration as well to break down those barriers and then allow people to access their right to a break.
Thank you. It must move on to our next theme that we want to discuss, and that is around data and information sharing. Stephanie Callaghan has questions on that.
Thanks very much. And just keeping in mind what Claire has said, we're now going to talk about an integrated and accessible electronic social care and health record. So maybe that's a bit of a mouthful and something we need to be having a wee think on there. So I'm very aware as well of the complexities around access, location, ownership, etc. And my first question is actually for Karen, and I'm wondering what she feels are the main benefits of having an electronic social care and health record. And I'm also interested in how we make that accessible. So for people, whether it's learning disabilities, whether it's literacy issues, or whether it's English not being their first language as well. So Claire might want to come in the back of that as well. Thanks, Karen.
Thanks. I think this is one of the things that we would really welcome in terms of the integrated health and care records. In the past, you know, all we have experienced real gaps in terms of people's, what's their life story. So how do you know how to support somebody really well? And without their background, their life story, that's really difficult today. We've also seen circumstances where there has been deliberate withholding of information to enable you to support somebody well, and some of that's around stereotypes and potential stigma that you may not want to support somebody if they have had a complex life or behavioural difficulties. So to support somebody really well, you need to know all that information. You absolutely need that, and we recognise that secondary legislation will be required to enable that sharing of information across the different sectors and the different parties that would need that. I think it's a cultural shift that we would need for people to adopt that. The systems that we have just now requires an immense amount of work and time and resource. There's often a lot of duplication of effort where you might have multiple records for an individual, and then trying to distill that to make sure that right information gets to the right people. And you see real inconsistencies in how that's done across different local authority and social work departments as well. So we would really welcome the integration of a health and social care record, because ultimately by doing that, people will be able to be supported better, because you'll have full access to their information. And it will allow us to help build care and support plans that reflects their individual needs, their wishes, their aspirations, and generally their outcomes. So how do you support somebody to have a really good life and be active citizens within their local communities? I think in terms of accessibility, that will require quite a lot of work, you know, especially for individuals who might have a learning disability. How do you present that information for them? How do their families get access to that data as well? Because that's really important. It's one of the things, you know, families have told us that they would like to see more involvement. So how do they actually engage with the care and support of their loved one as well? So I think we would have to do a lot of work within that secondary stage to make sure that it's accessible to individuals, and be able to present it in different communication methods and individuals can actually engage with as well. I think overall it's something that we really welcome. It won't be easy to disseminate and to get a broad agreement across the sector about what that looks like. I think we would welcome much more conversation in terms of that co-design phase, in terms of how do we make sure that we have the right information for individuals, but also that can be shared across those multiple platforms that's going to be required.
Thank you. Claire wants to come in, I'll bring Claire in.
Yeah, I think I would agree with Karen as well. I think one of the biggest things that comes to your mind when you talk about electronic integrated networks is digital exclusion, which cross-cuts lots of communities in Scotland. I think the important part to overcome that is about empowerment and empowering people to know that you can access it, but not only by the way you can access this via this link, however it looks like, but how do we access that? So I know for some of the organisations that we work with, specifically with elderly ethnic minority people, that simply they're not going to be able to access an electronic device. They don't have access maybe to the equipment. They might not have internet access. They might, if it's not in a language that their designated language that they use, then that these are everyday barriers that they face. So I think part of it is thinking about how would I make that better and how do we address the barriers? Sometimes we get stuck into identifying barriers and not thinking about the next step after it. And some of it might be identifying, having a nominated person to say that it might not be a relative, it might be your GP, it might be your social worker, it might be somebody who provides you care through a third sector organisation. You would like, you trust them, and I think trust is the whole part of it. And I think also empowering the families as well who maybe provide the care. So I'm thinking of unpaid carers or people who provide care, empowering them, not just saying this is the information that's on here, going into communities and saying if you want to learn about this, this is the information that's about you, this is how you access it, this is what we mean, this is the kind of information that it's on. And I think that's really required. I also think that, and it would be, I would presume that it would fall within secondary legislation, that we have to empower the people to say, when you're sharing information, for example, across boards, so an NHS board and maybe a care board, I think we have to empower people to say, is it okay that I share that information? There's obviously certain information that you have to share in terms of safeguarding and risk assessments, but some things people might not want them to share. So I can think of young people maybe that have maybe in the past been involved and had care and support. And when they transition to adult services, they might not want something that when they were 12, they had an incident, that then that reflects on when they're trying to get adult care, people then view that and go, oh, that's a bit too much trouble or too much, we don't want to provide care for that person. So I think we have to ask them, what information can I share? There's boundaries we have to respect to keep them safe and staff safe, but really we should be asking people and not just by a please tick this box if you're okay with sharing. Tell people what that really means. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. So that kind of leads me on to my next question for Hannah. I was going to ask, should social care users have ownership of an access to a single integrated electronic care record? And if you think they should, then how could that actually work effectively on the ground in practical terms?
If I may amend that suggestion, I think it's not just about the electronic record. I think it's about care records. And yes, you know, echoing comments about digital access, any system we design cannot exclude 20% or whatever proportion of the population based on digital literacy. But
created an accessible record is that all the information is in the one place, but I appreciate that.
I just wanted to make that explicit about access. The access point.
Yeah.
Agreed that you don't want this in a massive paper filing cabinet. I think citizen control should be in primary legislation, so not just access but control. And I think that this is something we've heard from across our membership, so I'm speaking more broadly. Specifically, what that means is right to state who has graduated access, as outlined by Claire. So, you know, maybe your physio needs information on your day-to-day personal care needs. They probably don't need to know you had postnatal depression 20 years ago, that kind of detail. And in practice, that also means ensuring in secondary legislation that there is provision made for the training up of individuals to access and control data about themselves, but also to ensure empowerment and training of all sorts of social care people providing social care, including unpaid carers, the third sector, independent providers, local authority of health and social care partnership providers. At the moment, my understanding of the legislation is there's not explicit engagement with who has the right to access that within the third sector as well. And I think that would be really important to tailor to ensure that it applies to as broad a range of people as the citizen in question is happy to have access. That also needs to include guardianship situations explicitly.
On to the next line of questioning, Barry.
Yeah, I support everything that has been said, but I do think we need to inject a degree of pragmatism into this, and that the individuals who are probably most likely to be disadvantaged by the open sharing of information, the disclosures that they're likely to have made, particularly complex backgrounds with multiple ACEs, these are all individuals that we see through services that we run. They are the individuals who are least likely to exercise any of the rights that we have discussed. And training, quite frankly, won't do anything at all. So I think we need to make sure that there are safeguards in place that we don't disenfranchise those who are the most vulnerable to what's potentially being put in place. And that's going to require more than potentially independent advocacy, but a real consideration to helping individuals who have become institutionalised, potentially from being in care as a young person and as an adult in multiple instances, possibly through prison, or quite frankly, just intensive public sector involvement in their lives, who have it has become a social norm to share everything about themselves. I think that there's a wee bit of thought that needs to be thought through around how we protect those who are most vulnerable in those circumstances. Those who've got capacity and agency themselves to undertake those, absolutely. But not everybody is on the same footing, and that needs to be recognised somewhere.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I move on to questions from Gillian Mackay? Gillian.
Thanks, convener. What challenges currently face social care users and carers when making complaints? How could these challenges be addressed by the bill? And are there any ways, in your opinions, that you would like to see the complaints handling provisions of the bill altered and or strengthened, and for what reasons? You're nodding at me, Fanny.
Yeah. So one of the things that comes back reasonably regularly through forum discussions with service providers and people who support individuals who might be making complaints, more often than not, it's differentiating the difference between the system and the structures and the institution from the individuals in front of them. A lot of the time, they actually feel very protective over the individuals who have direct support. But it's still not okay, as in like a carer turning up to put somebody to bed well before
you know, 7 o'clock, 6 o'clock at night. Their frustration is that to complain would seem as though they are criticising the individual, and it's trying to differentiate between the two. And then there's an element whereby where the complaints themselves are being handled and where they're being processed. By experience, I would say that many of us will have, I've no doubt, raised concerns about aspects of things that have been happening within the system. And the knee-jerk reaction that I've experienced is defensiveness, not openness and willing to explore. And I could give you multiple examples, except for I wouldn't in a public committee. but I think that there is something about we need more independence in the pathway, more independence in investigating what's actually gone and happened, not as a secondary tier, but as a primary tier in the complaints process. And we need to encourage individuals to understand that when something isn't working right, I think the word complaint is part of the barrier. Actually, I want to raise the fact, I don't like this. Could we change it? Because that's not a complaint then against, you know, Sandra, who's come in to come and help me, and I like her. I just don't like what's happening around it. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Hannah.
Seconded. And just to build on that, something that explicitly prioritises improvement processes, and I think that links to your language point, including a system that enables staff to put forward those proposals and those concerns, which isn't always in place consistently at the moment, and I think compounds those issues. Also, that would be part of a co-production approach to enable as many people as possible to provide constructive input throughout the life of a system. The other thing that I would flag as an important element of it is that in many cases our current complaint system, if someone passes away, that's it, job's done. It doesn't go any further. And that's a real problem, because it means with people in palliative or end of life care, you don't have the capacity to follow through on concerns that have been raised within that sort of situation, or in situations where someone has passed away while a complaints process is lumbering along. Family don't necessarily have the same right to follow that through, and that's learning lost, bluntly. So any system needs to be flexible enough to accommodate that while respecting GDPR and everything else.
Claire?
Yeah, I would agree with both Mary and Hannah, and I think, again, just to build on it, that a lot of the time if people complain more than once, or even just like Mary said, I don't like this, they get tarnished with you're the complainer, and then their standard of service changes, usually to their detriment. And that's a real fear, especially amongst people who receive self-directed support, is that I'm afraid to say I don't like this, in case then they pull more money away from me. Because again, and it's people, one, on the one hand, people are afraid that they don't want to complain about the individual providing the care, it's the system they've got a problem with. But on the other hand, it's about complaining. It's just the change of the language. We want to complain about the system, but if the system doesn't allow you to complain, there's nowhere else to go, and you become more disenfranchised. And it's one of the other things is it's really difficult to make a complaint. People don't know where to go. They get sent phone this number, you get switched into that number, and it's just not accessible. And I think one of the other things that we need to take into consideration is that when you're making complaints and information gets shared, so you might phone to make a complaint and a note gets lodged for somebody to follow up, we have to take into consideration things like people's own microaggressions, people's own unconscious bias, institutional racism, because that those little notes on little comments can then affect how the next person reads that, how that. So what is there in place to make sure that we are making sure that those who are on the front line of, as well as having the processes in place, those in the front line receiving the complaints, how aware are they of these issues for people?
Really helpful. Don wants to come in?
Yep, it was just quickly, I think this is back to independent advocacy again and the importance of that. And I think the bill currently states that ministers may bring forward regulations to ensure that people using national care services have access to independent advocacy. But I think, you know, around this sort of issue, it's particularly important that people can access that advocacy.
And I'll bring in Paul.
my follow-up question was on how we make sure that that complaints process is transparent and accessible for everyone. I think Claire summed it up very well that at the moment, due to the number of different providers and where and when and to who you can complain to those different providers, it makes it a complete spider's web of issues, especially if you have service users who English is not their first language or there are any other access issues there. How can we ensure that any national level process takes accountability of geographic variability and who the providers are, as well as access issues, to make sure that the complaint system is fit for purpose and is well advertised how to access and how to navigate through it, so that if for any reason someone doesn't want to take up independent advocacy or doesn't have someone there to advocate for them, can still navigate it in their own way and in their own time.
Just gonna go to Barry afterwards.
I think to be transparent, if we're in the first instance and we're not going round independent advocacy route, having the information about how we access complaints in EasyRead, having them in different languages, having them available. But there's also something to be said about breaking down those barriers. So some people feel that I should be grateful enough that I get anything. So to complain, especially amongst elderly people, seems like they don't want to complain about things. We've also got this institutional, within ethnic minority communities, this institutionalised feeling of being told for generations that they're a burden on the state. So we've seen that with some work that we've done with Social Security Scotland in accessing that, but it's the same for social care. It's changing the mindset that, no, you have the right to this care, but you also have the right to make sure that you like it and maybe frame it like that and not frame it like a complaint, because framing something as complaint usually is something negative, but it's not personable to the person. Sometimes it is, and you want to complain about the person who has delivered that care to you, but I think we have to break down that barrier of, no, this is your right to complain and going into communities, changing if it's access when you're giving that support, saying, remember that this is available. But not just that, we have to think, and people are better placed than me to say that, because people who provide the care and the people who are receiving the care should be at the heart of that process.
Thank you. Barry.
I was smiling because you mentioned Social Security Scotland. I, in relation to how do we get the balance right, get our footprint within local communities, I really do think that there's a lot the committee could learn in terms of how Social Security Scotland is unrolling its engagement process on a local basis. Because right now, we've asked them to come back in a couple of years' time. I'm sure we will have some complaints by that point in time. But right now, everything that they're doing is just really encouraging, and we're getting incredible feedback from local areas. So I think if you're looking at how to take that forward, I would encourage you to look no further than them.
That's really good feedback as well for us here. Hannah?
And on a connected point, although we've been talking a lot about what isn't working, I think there also is learning in parts of the country about where complaints are well dealt with. One of my colleagues did a bit of work around assessing what information is available publicly on local authority websites around complaints. And some of them have very clear information on this is who will contact you, this is the timeline. And even on a very basic level, knowing what your expectations are is helpful. Did they have BSL? Some of them have, so Glasgow City Council have community language information. It's not absolutely everything, but you know, that is a step in the right direction. And I think that comms work is really difficult to understate how important that is. I would also twin that with the need to have proactive working with local community groups who have that built trust, who can address those kinds of concerns that Claire is raising. And I think actually just putting the really basics out there is really powerful. That can also be twinned. I know there are some colleagues within social work who have, as part of their standard information pack they give out on every assessment visit to individuals in the community, it's information about your local independent advocacy organisation, it's information about how do you raise concerns. I think it's that language that is used in the one I'm thinking of in question. But that's good examples of good practice. You know, not everything is awful.
there are plenty of problems, but draw on that and use that to go forward.
Paul, you had a question on this.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I suppose when we had the Public Service Ombudsman before us, they would have raised concern about duplication in processes if we go for a new national complaints procedure. And I think SSSC and Key Inspector would probably say similar things in various spaces. So I wonder if I can just ask, I mean, would the intention be that there would be a requirement to resource a new national complaints service? I mean, essentially to spend money on people to handle those complaints at a more national level, to then feed back to whoever is providing the care and do the investigation, if you like. You know, is that the vision that people have kind of seen through this consultation? And then I know that Karen Sheridan through Community Integrated Care had said that there was a concern that taking it out of the local context is maybe not helpful. So I don't know if Karen, if we've got time, wants to comment on that as well.
I maybe go to the in-house panel first before I go to Karen.
Now, but that was an independent process through which you could raise a concern, not necessarily a complaint. So I suppose there's two, three things. One is, from my impression from feedback given in relation to the bill from members was that they would prefer an independent process that links straight back to the government, because that's the avenue at which they would see their ability to hold you to account to some extent. But I think on a practical level, there is something about making sure that there is a local aspect to that. And possibly rather than setting up a new service per se, there is an opportunity to commission on a local basis, that concept of an independence at first stage that's not necessarily about creating up a new bureaucratic process, if that makes any sense, and looking at examples around PASS might be an option.
Could you maybe just re-emphasise what your point was? Because you want to ask Karen a particular question, she might not have caught it all.
Sure. No, we were just talking about the complaints system, and I'd noticed that Community Integrated Care had said in their submission that that local level is actually quite important in terms of responding to complaints at the as close essentially to where they occur as possible. I'm paraphrasing, obviously. But I wondered if Karen had any comment on the kind of complaints procedure and the importance of that locality.
I think when we spoke to some of the people who use our services and their families and carers around the complaints process, there was a real strong feeling that there should still be that localised element of it. So where things can be done very quickly, you know, engaging with their provider, with their local authority, with the care inspectorate, in terms of making sure that there's something in the conversations, isn't there, when you're making a complaint? You want it to be an easy process. You want to make sure that you're being heard. And there was just a feeling that happens better when it's somebody local that maybe knows you, knows your family, knows the communities that you're living in as well. I mean, there still needs to be a process, I think, for when somebody wants to challenge a decision as well. And when somebody feels that they haven't been heard, which is where I think if there's more serious complaints, it can't be resolved and there is something in terms of a more nationalised structure. But I think in terms of speed for individuals, people would like to see a local response, you know, certainly for people that we worked with. But some of the other things that were quite key to them was making sure that they had help and support to make a complaint. And one of the things I think Dawn had already touched on is that advocacy. So how do people access advocacy that will help them to do that? And then making sure that it's available in those different accessible formats for individuals. But in terms of local response, there was a clear request that people are still able to raise their concerns locally to get quick and speedy responses to that.
We've got 10 minutes left. So we have a final theme. We've talked about co-design quite a lot throughout the whole session, but we have specific questions on co-design from Paul Kane and then from Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel for indulging me again. But essentially, co-design is to be at the heart of the process, and obviously we are going to have an element of co-design, as we understand, in the secondary part of the bill, if you like. I mean, can we maybe just start with, do you feel that that was the right way to do it, or would you rather have seen more co-design at the front end before we got to a legislative process?
Claire?
There's a lot to be learned in the co-design processes so far on this bill and the experiences, and we can take the learning away from that and improve on it, because there was a lot of unhappiness and a lot of exclusions within the co-design process. Co-design should start at the beginning. It should always be at the start, because then you've got this issue of fitting the people's needs and wants within your own framework. It should never be retrospective. I always say that co-design is like dotting the I's and crossing the T's. You should really have a diverse workforce. You should really ensure that in the National Care Service, and the people that are providing support, people like a more strategic approach, people involved in the care boards that are being proposed, they should be a diverse workforce. It shouldn't be pulled from the same talent pool that we know that social services is not a diverse workforce. And I think that is something that we really need to take into consideration, because after that, co-design is important, and I would never say that it's not, but you then have this issue of trying to meet what came out of the co-design into a process that you've spent lots of time and lots of money on doing. So I think it should be at the first and foremost at the point, at the initial stages.
Okay. Anyone else like to? Dawn?
Yeah, I mean, I would agree with that. I also personally think that co-design should be on the face of the primary legislation as well, because I think there appears to be quite a disconnect between what is said within the policy memorandum and the sort of language that we're seeing on the face of the bill, which talks about consultation as opposed to co-design. And in some cases, it's about consultation after a draft strategy has already been, you know, produced. So that doesn't really strike me as being proper co-design. So I think I prefer to see that, you know, clearly set out within the primary legislation as to what that will actually mean in practice.
Okay. Hannah, do you want to come in?
I think only to reiterate my point about threading through the legislation, ensuring that people are included in decision making, not just in consultation. So I think I made that point, but flagging it.
Fears repeating. Paul, do you have any more questions for hand over to Evelyn?
No, I'll let Evelyn.
That wasn't a hint.
No, it's all.
Evelyn.
Thanks, convener. Yes, so co-design. I'm keen that we move forward with co-design so that you all feel that you're included, that you've got a say. And I think we've kind of caught the general drift that you don't really know what it looks like just now. So I would like to ask Mary, for rural and remote areas, how can we make sure we're inclusive, listening? And you spoke about the challenges earlier, such a huge area. What does good co-design look like for you?
Good co-design has to start out on an even footing. And so whether that's actually in the development of this piece of legislation or actually what comes after this in terms of the governance processes, we need to give some serious thought to where does the capacity for the co-design come from. So if that means involving individuals who have some form of a barrier to participating, now in remote and rural areas that might be transport, but it might actually be transport and the fact that they're an unpaid carer and the fact that they've got a part-time job as well. So actually, how do we remove those barriers from social care provider's role? Well, if you're already incredibly short-staffed, how can you possibly travel to Inverness for a piece of work to do that? If you're from the third sector, we're already running on absolute zero capacity to do anything. So to participate on an even footing with individuals who might be coming from a committee with a number of clerks and background supports, etc., we're already at a significant disadvantage in terms of how we participate. So truthfully, I think what we need to see is investment in the capacity of all of the audiences that you want to see participating in co-design. I think we need to make sure that we're very clear about that sense of we're achieving something. I've participated myself in a number of things, and it's very difficult to identify, particularly when you're talking about policy development or pieces of legislation or changing elements of practice or systems change. to see and evidence to feel like I have achieved something. And so your ability or interest in participating becomes less because you can't see the pathways to how you're making any difference. And when you've all those pressures of your normal work life or home life or just circumstances pushing in on that, it becomes really difficult to justify the time, the energy, the travel, and the cost. And that's often hidden in co-design, the cost to actually go to somewhere, the cost of giving up a piece of work or getting somebody else to cover it. So truthfully, I think we need to look at resourcing, capacity, and I don't think that moving everything to a digital platform is the solution to that.
Okay. Hannah.
Just also responding, I would say there's a lot to be learned from groups like the People-Led Policy Panel in terms of the longevity of that and the building of and empowering folk to engage, as well as proper financing and resourcing. There's also something about feedback loops that I think is really important, whereas at the moment there is, I know from colleagues in civil service, a huge amount of good work going on, but it's not necessarily fully transparent what has happened, who has been involved, why those individuals have been chosen, and I think that also goes to public trust. So I think not asking for anonymity to be breached, because that's obviously a GDPR concern and other ethical questions as well, but there is something about public transparency of process and of, you know, you said, we did sort of logics that I think needs to be part of any process.
Okay. What's follow-up at all? Or Claire wants to come back in, if I can bring Claire back in.
Expand on what both Mary and Hannah have said, and I think to me what good co-design would look like and what it would feel like would be that you're, when you're creating a co-design service for people to get involved, that you use a human rights-based approach, you use the panel principles which are endorsed by our Scottish Human Rights Commission, or UN endorsed. It's a framework such to take you through a process of making sure that you are as inclusive, you're breaking down those barriers as much as you can, and it's about, I think, the importance of using a human rights-based approach is it captures intersectionality, and that can often be left out in co-design. We'll have you because you have a disability, and we'll have you because you're from an ethnic minority background, but what about the ethnic minority person who has a disability? So, and their experience is entirely different. So the importance of a human rights-based approach is that it captures intersectionality because it focuses on the human being and not their protected characteristic. I think, and you know, other things that it ensures is things that Mary has talked about the empowerment, making sure that at every stage of the process that you're being updated on what's happened. So I've collected the information, I've shared it with the committee, this is the action, this is the recommendation, this is how it's been implemented across the whole stage of the process, because otherwise people become apathetic and they'll never participate again, because they're like, what did that achieve? I gave you, and I might have disclosed some really difficult things about my experience through care, and you've not even told me what it was for. And I think it also comes back to valuing people and valuing our time. We talk a lot about valuing lived experience, but we don't actually value lived experience, because a lot of the time we don't value people for their time. We might cover their transport costs to participate, but what if they have to take the day off work? What if they're having to pay for another family member to get the bus over to look after that person? We need to really, if you're valuing lived experience, you pay for their experience, just like you would pay for somebody else to come into a room and speak.
I think that is a great note to end on, and we could speak to you for a lot longer, but we have run out of time, got a second panel to change over. So I'm going to suspend this part of the meeting to allow that panel change over. I want to thank the five of you for your time this afternoon. It's been very, very helpful. Okay. We move to our second evidence session on the National Care Service Bill, and I'm delighted to welcome those attending in person first, and then I'll mention those we have online. We've got Frank McKillop, the Head of Policy and Research for Enable Scotland, and we have Andy Miller, the Strategic Lead for Participation and Practice Lead for the Scottish Commission for People with Learning Disabilities. And online we have Dr Caroline Gould, the Trustee and Access Author of Skell and McCulloch Access Panel, Dr Pauline Nolan, the Head of Leadership and Civic Participation for Inclusion Scotland, and Rona Wilder, the Development Manager for the Scottish Independent Advocacy Alliance. So welcome to you all. If I could maybe just put the first sort of question to you that I guess I do every time, and I did in the first panel as well, about how you feel the bill as it's drafted could be strengthened. And I'm going to go around everyone, not every colleague will have the luxury of going through round everyone because we won't have time, but we're going to take convener's privilege in that regard just to start things off. So if I go to Frank first of all.
Yeah, thanks convener, and thanks again to the committee for inviting us to participate. I think where we feel there's perhaps something missing, and it may be an accident rather than in purpose, is the reference to self-directed support. That was something we were quite surprised not to see written into the bill. There are the references to person-centred support, and I think what we often find is that those are interchangeable and wrongly interchangeable terms. So I think it's certainly something we would like to see is that self-directedness being at the heart of the bill. That is particularly important if we're going to achieve human rights of people that access care services, which is, you know, rightly and nobly a high priority for the National Care Service. So I think certainly that is something we would like to see written into the bill, is that right to self-directed support. I think a second priority that we would like to see written in is the community first principle for social care, that the priority at all times is to enable people to have support within the community where they want to live, and that any institutional or congregate living arrangements would only be something someone would have as their choice. They have chosen to live with other people or in a particular building-based service. There should always be a community first principle. And that's something, again, the learning from the pandemic has led us towards that place. We know it's something a number of local authorities are increasingly thinking about, is to have as much care as possible delivered within community settings. And that's definitely something Enable supports and something we'd like to see in the bill. And I think, thirdly, the other thing we think would be an important addition to the bill is that principle that care would be free at the point of use. And again, I know that is something that is in the wider National Care Service project, that is something the Scottish Government says they want to achieve. But of course, it's not written into the bill. And I think whenever we've had members events at Enable with our members coming to participate, people who have learning disabilities themselves, people who access care services and their family members and carers, it is always the question they ask. You know, we can give a beautiful slide presentation about the National Care Service bill. It's the first question is always, is care and support going to be free? And at the moment, you know, we can't say it definitely will. We hope that the direction of travel is towards that, but I think that is the understanding. Obviously, National Care Service echoes National Health Service. I think that's very deliberate, and I think it is important to remember that in the minds of people who aren't like me, that are involved in all the policy and in the weeds of what's in the bill, when people hear National Care Service, their immediate assumption is this means care and support is free when I need it, just like the NHS is, and I think we have to ensure that the legislation gets us to that place and to meet those expectations.
Okay, thank you. Andy?
Thanks for inviting us, first of all, to this committee meeting this afternoon. I'm very pleased to be here. I hope it's not going to be a very boring afternoon for you where I just repeat everything that Frank said, but we would very much echo a lot of those points. The lack of reference to self-directed support, I think it's a big miss, and we didn't really understand why it's such an important part of social care work. Well, it's the mechanism by which social care should work well, and it was a theme that Derek Feely really spent a lot of time considering on how that could be put right. So that was a bit mystifying. And in general, I suppose the point that we would make about what would make the bill better is that it is to, there's a lack of detail, and the Feely report was so gave people so much optimism and hope about a transformation in social care. And I think what was missing from the bill was any kind of detail about how this new structure, which there was a fair amount of detail about, would bring about all those great outcomes that Feely mentioned. It wasn't just the outcomes that Feely talked about. He did talk about some specific things, and again, Frank mentioned them, caring free at the point of care, support being free at the point of care, and that kind of breaking down of the binary system that eligibility criteria creates, where you're assessed as being eligible or not, and if you're assessed as not being eligible, you essentially get nothing. And Feely's vision was very much of some kind of spectrum of support, where whatever your needs were for support, you were eligible for that level of need. And there's nothing really in the bill that shows how that can be brought about. And fundamentally, I suppose, we would say that the principles in the bill are fantastic. We would totally support them, but there's not the detail in the bill about how they're going to be brought about. And the big fear that we've got is that the focus of the bill is all about the structure of the new service. And the way it was presented, there was a dislocation between those terrific aspirational principles and the structure it was laid out. And we were left feeling that if that structure was put into place, it would not deliver the outcomes that were talked about in Feely and aspired to in the principles. And I'm not sure whether this is covered in your question, but we would have to say that what's in the financial memorandum as well was disappointing and sort of reinforced that fear that that what will be delivered by the bill is a structure, but none of the vision which Feely hoped for.
That may be because quite a lot of the detail that you're looking for is going to come after the co-design process. And do you recognise that that's the vehicle? Because it was very successful in the Social Security Act, that co-design is going to inform that secondary legislation? Or do you feel that there has to be more detail ahead of that co-design?
We're really hoping that that'll be the case. And clearly that's what's been promised. The detail will come in secondary legislation. And that's fine. Just in terms of the finance, we're not sure if more finance will come with the secondary legislation. But there were so many big ticket items that were specifically excluded in the financial memorandum, which would be fundamental to the success of the new social care service.
That's really helpful. And of course, we have the Minister in front of us just before we break for Christmas. So we'll be able to put all these questions to him. If I can go to those joining us online, if I can, Caroline Gould could come in. Caroline?
Thank you. I would have liked to have been there in person today. However, no one seemed to consider to ask my needs as a disabled person who uses a large powered wheelchair and who needs to employ carers and who has an unpaid carer and is also an unpaid carer, or of the time required to enable what needs to be put in place to support me get there and be there and to stay overnight. That initially disappoints me completely, given what we're here to talk to today. Whilst I like some of the principles in that, I'm also concerned about when we say human rights, what are we referring to? Are we referring to the possible future Human Rights Scotland Bill, or are we talking to current human rights? Also, where is the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities coming into this? I feel that in the processes in which I've been involved through the Social Covenant Steering Group, the People-Led Policy Panel and others, there has been almost a constant fight for disabled people and the disabled people whom I represent and their unpaid and paid carers to actually be heard in any real way. And I'm wondering that when we're talking about even going to a stage two, what is going to happen beforehand? Because what happened first was the consultation was formed without disabled people's input. And the consultation results proved that that was a mistake. Now we're actually, as disabled people, almost being asked to run before we can walk, to keep up, because it's a process that started and it's just going to run over us if we can't keep up. But I'm not seeing a huge amount being done to allow us to keep up or be on a level playing field with others. So I would actually seriously question whether you really want our views. And I'm sorry to have to say this. I have to say Social Covenant Steering Group, People-Led Policy Panel, I've been pleased with Social Covenant Steering Group is improving. However, a lot of things that I think people don't necessarily realise. I mean, in a remote rural area such as Skye and Lough Alsh, when you pay a carer so much for an hour, you may get them at most for 11 minutes before they then have to go and drive another 45 miles to somebody else. And all of these long distances mean that it's not easy then for them to come back because nobody's paying their fuel. You get, I think, person-centred completely wrong. Person-centred, I'm told, should be being centred on the needs of the person who needs care. But in my and other people in Skye Lough Alsh's area, what we find is person-centred means a load of social workers, integrated team members, in a room talking about you, which is often overheard, and then you're told in the local supermarket car park what was said about you because your confidentiality is breached. But at no point are you being told what is discussed about you as the centred person here, the person for whom these decisions are being made. And that has to drastically change. Certainly, I would like to see much more in relation to SDS in this bill, in reference to it. I also am very concerned about access to notes, particularly in a remote rural area, but particularly because 60% of disabled people are unable to access or use digital technology. So why should they be forced into a method which clearly doesn't work for them? We've seen that throughout the pandemic, where disabled people tell us that they feel even worse than second-class citizens, which is what they would have called themselves before the pandemic. And I think disabled people and people with long-term illnesses need, and their unpaid carers need, to be included, because it's all too easy, as I discovered recently, to go into hospital to visit my husband to find, oh, you're his wife. Oh, great. That's the unpaid carer. We can send him home now. I mean, when I can't get my care needs fulfilled, let alone he resigned as my unpaid carer 6 years ago, and it's still being ignored by the NHS. This is what it's like to be in a remote rural area. You don't know how many calls I get from people who tell me, my neighbour came in to visit me in hospital. They didn't want me bed blocking. My neighbour was asked, could they do this for me? And they went, yeah, I could do that once in a while. Okay, well, then the neighbour is suddenly their unpaid carer. There is no formality that should be there. There is no independent advocacy when you need it. There are not enough people doing it. There aren't enough carers. I mean, the distances involved don't seem to be understood at all by people in cities who are the ones who are mainly the decision makers. I would like to see a lot more understanding of these things. I mean, to actually want to have your rights under the Human Rights Act fulfilled, not to have a social worker, not to have somebody constantly coming into your house, a doctor or whatever. You want to go and see them as you would normally, have a meeting with them and be told, oh,
No, we can't do that because there isn't somewhere where your wheelchair can get in or where you can go to the toilet, including our brand new Broadford Hospital, just opened in March this year. If you can't get that right and allow people are being forced more and more to be backed into their homes in a way in which they don't want and their privacy invaded. And I really think remote rural living has to come a lot more forward in this and show understanding of it, because so far it's not happening.
Thank you. There's a lot of what you're saying, my colleagues will want to come in on the detail of that. I think we'll come back into quite a lot of the things that you've brought up, Dr. Gould. Can I come to Pauline Nolan?
And thanks for inviting Inclusion Scotland and me to speak on behalf of Inclusion Scotland and also the people-led policy panel, which we support, which is a group of disabled people, supported people and unpaid carers who need social care support, who are co-designing, co-producing social care support. We'll come back to that. So things that we think are probably missing from the bill, I will elaborate on some of what my colleagues have said. So Article 19 of the UN Convention on the Rights of Disabled People really explains how support should be given to disabled people, that it should be in the community, away from institutions, that it's independent living means having choice, control, dignity and respect. It doesn't mean looking after yourself or fending for yourself, which maybe it could be misconstrued as, but it means having the supports you need to have that right upheld. And it's a really, really important enabling right. It's connected to a number of other rights in the convention. So, for example, travel and transport, employment, being involved in the community, being able to participate and uphold your civic rights, and rights to family life and so on. So it's really, really important. In fact, as colleagues have said, self-directed support isn't mentioned in the bill, and that's a massive omission. But also the rights to independent living are laid out within the self-directed support bill. So we consider that to be really important. Other things that are missing, as colleagues have said, charges, but I'm aware that that's been worked on in the background to remove unpaid charges, but I don't think it's as far on as it could be or should be, which is a little bit concerning. But I agree that social care support should be free at the point of delivery. Also, what's missing, housing, that always comes up when we consult. Over the years, I've consulted on social care support when the integration bill came in for the public bodies bill. People wanted to connect housing because a lot of support is received in housing. I realise that's a complex area, but it could be looked at in future. Doing equality and human rights impact assessments is missing. And the financial memorandum doesn't mention how different types of advocacy will be funded. So we want to give a big shout out for Centres for Inclusive Living, for example, which provides other kinds of disabled people's organisations, which provide the very initial supports for people accessing social care support in an independent way, and then peer support and peer advice from other disabled people who've been in the system. So that could be in there, and that should be an ongoing investment. And finally, there's an issue with the care boards in that my colleague Hannah earlier from the Alliance mentioned, is that it talks about co-designing what the care boards will look like, but it doesn't talk about how that will be an ongoing feature of the care board. And that governance is a real omission, that participation isn't included in that governance and isn't there on the face of the bill. It should really be there as a human rights-based approach, because participation is the first initial in panel, which is the human rights-based approach. So there's amendments that could be made to that section.
Yeah, there'll be ample opportunity to get quite a lot of the points that you want to make throughout the session. And can I go to Rona Wilder next, and then I will hand over to my colleague Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for inviting us along today to represent independent advocacy and our membership. We're particularly pleased to see independent advocacy mentioned in section 13. Although, as one of my colleagues mentioned on the first panel, it does say in the bill currently that Scottish ministers may, by regulations, make provision about independent advocacy. We feel that currently this doesn't really have any teeth, and the framework legislation in this form means that how independent advocacy will look in practice is unclear. We have three particular concerns around this. Number one, that there's not a definition of independent advocacy currently in the bill. Two, that the right of access to independent advocacy is not there, and there's not a duty to provide independent advocacy. We're concerned that this means that this will all fall to secondary legislation, and this narrows scrutiny. We know from other pieces of legislation that how independent advocacy sits within primary legislation is key to how it is accessed by people in practice. For example, in the Mental Health Care Treatment Scotland Act 2003, it includes this right of access to independent advocacy, meaning that people that find themselves under the Act can access independent advocacy better than they can when they fall under other pieces of legislation where there's not that right of access or the duty to provide. So having independent advocacy very clearly stated as a right in primary legislation, we feel is incredibly important in how it then looks in practice. We have several other concerns, but for initial kind of look at the bill, that is what we're most concerned about. Thank you.
Thank you to you all for sort of like setting out your stall, I suppose, and that's why I always do this, going around the whole panel. Colleagues, a reminder that you don't have that luxury. If you can direct your questions to individual members of the panel, that would be hugely helpful. And over to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, convener. I think I'll come back to Rona first on this question. Should a single organisation such as Citizens Advice Scotland be appointed to provide or coordinate the provision of independent advocacy, or do you see this happening in a different way under the Act?
Thank you. So we would say initially that advice and independent advocacy are very different types of services. They're mutually supportive, but they are separate. So independent advocacy is under the SIA definition that's agreed by our members across Scotland, says that people that are accessing independent advocacy should not be put under pressure to receive any undue advice from the independent advocates. Independent advocates are there to help people to access information, to understand what their rights are, and to gather their views, and then to help the people that they're working with, and that might be people within the National Care Service, to understand those views and understand their opinions and what they might want to happen, but they would never be there to provide advice. So we would see independent advocacy, we would hope to see it be provided at a local level, but potentially procured nationally. This would mean that the conflict of interest that often arises at a local level when services are procured through their local health and social care partnerships, that conflict of interest isn't so apparent if it was a national procurement model. We would like to see but still that local provision of independent advocacy, and we feel that's very important for independent advocacy to be rooted in communities. Our members tell us that frequently. The independent advocacy they provide is strongest when they are able to be embedded in their local communities.
That's great. On complaints, particularly for, and could I come to Dr. Polly Nolan maybe on this one? What are the key considerations for yourselves when we're looking at developing a model complaint system for the proposed National Care Service and for service users that you support? What do you see the biggest barriers being in a nationally structured model of complaints?
Yeah, So a lot of disabled people, supported people, currently feel very much unheard when it comes to complaints. It's very difficult. There was a lot of talk about this in the first session, about, you know, the people that you go to complain to is the same people that will be making future decisions about your social care support. We absolutely have to get away from that and onto an independent complaint system. Unlike advocacy, I sort of echo what Rona was saying about advocacy. It should be, I think it should be a mixed economy of advocacy. I think there should be a national advocacy training, but delivery should be very localised. But when it comes to a complaint system, there should be a national complaint system that is independent completely from the National Care Service, from the providers of social care support as it currently is. That's really important. It needs to be developed and co-designed from the ground up. It shouldn't use other complaint systems as a basis. We need that approach to co-design in a complaint system. That's what panel members told us, because it's so unique when it comes to social care support. And one panel member said that, you know, they phoned up to complain about a service and they were told, oh, why are you complaining? I thought, can't you say something positive? And it's, well, no, this needs to be separate. Feedback is separate from complaints. So that's also an important distinction. Just going back to your question, can you just go through it again, please? Because I was looking through my notes. I've got lots of notes here.
I think you've probably covered most of it. So what are the key considerations in developing a model complaint system, and really what pitfalls do we have to look out for, particularly when we're considering service users from your point of view?
Yeah, I think the other thing is to consider the right to redress, what happens after a complaint, and also access, making sure that complaint system is completely accessible for all disabled people, that any system includes information in accessible formats about what will happen throughout the complaints service. Because let's face it, anybody coming to complaints to complain about their social care support or a decision that's been made is already extremely stressed out. So it needs to be completely accessible with different formats, different languages, easy read, BSL, etc. But also it needs to set out very clearly what will happen and what will happen afterwards. And when it comes to service failures, there needs to be definitive commitments about what the redress will be as well. And that should be in the bill.
That's great. Thank you. That's me, convener. Thank you.
James, you wanted to come in?
Question for Rona. And it's about access to the independent advocacy service. Should it be a right for everyone using the service, NCS, or should it be restricted to certain groups, for instance, those with a disability?
I suppose that it's slightly dependent on how independent advocacy sits currently with provision across the country. We would like to see independent advocacy accessible to everyone that uses the service, but there should still remain specialist provision for people within protected groups. So we've seen in the most recent independent review of the Mental Health Act that opt-out independent advocacy provision is one of the recommendations. And in order to align with that, it would be useful for the National Care Service Bill to include an opt-out independent advocacy provision for anyone that uses the service. But I would make sure to add to that that currently there's a lot of specialist knowledge and provision for groups, including people with learning disabilities and disabled people, around independent advocacy because of how independent advocacy has grown in Scotland. So there's a lot of specialist knowledge and understanding of working with advocacy partners that have learning disabilities, for example, and that shouldn't be lost if there is opt-out advocacy provision for everybody that uses the National Care Service.
Yeah, I suppose, and I mean, I've outed the experts on this one, but I suppose that part of the danger, if everybody's getting access to yourselves, that those that might need it most might lose out. Is that a fear? Or?
I think if the service of independent advocacy was resourced sufficiently and there was a procurement model that worked across Scotland, I don't think that that would be a concern. I think because of how independent advocacy is currently procured and the current groups that are missed out of the groups that currently should be provided to that aren't provided to, for example, there's gaps around children and young people that should be have independent advocacy under the Mental Health Act that don't receive it. That's an example of where independent advocacy should be providing a service but currently aren't. I think those kind of gaps could be rectified by a good procurement model and sufficient resources.
So that's an opportunity for the co-production to come into play then?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, James. I'm going to move on to self-directed support and transitions, which a lot of people have already mentioned in their opening remarks. And this is going to be led by Emma Harper. Emma.
Thanks, convener. Good afternoon, everybody, and to the folks online as well. Self-directed support is something that I've been interested in pursuing, even in the last session of Parliament, because we've heard evidence that it isn't being delivered good or well in some places, but it's absolutely fantastic in other places. So, and self-directed support seems to offer people the choice of what kind of care they want. So I'd be interested to hear whether you think there should be more of it in the bill, and if so, what should it say? Because looking at the bill directly in front of me and on page 20 and 21, talks about modifying self-directed support legislation. So I'm interested in what your thoughts are about self-directed support, and then should there be more of it in the bill?
Is there anyone in particular I'd like to go to first, Emma?
Not really, just who's the self-directed support expert?
Well, maybe go to Dr. Gould first.
Sorry, could you repeat what it was you asked? I'm not an expert on SDS, however, I'm in receipt of it. I deal with a lot of other people who are. But I think the main problem for us in a remote rural area is finding enough carers. They're not being recruited, being well enough paid, they're not being retained. Some are given short-term, six-month, one-year contracts. When they do, if they do move to this area, then their spouse or partner has to also find a job. They have to find childcare. They have to find a home to live in. All of these things prevent actually having enough carers for people to actually achieve SDS. There aren't agencies where you can go because many of these have closed over the last 10 years or so. So your choice is you have to do all the hard work because the NHS doesn't tell you where you can go to get your carers locally unless you use Care at Home, which is already oversubscribed and therefore not readily available. And the other problem is that a lot of people don't understand. Well, for a start, we have people here who have had independent care reviews way back in early 2018 who have been told their care needs have never been assessed properly. That needs to happen now with someone who has an understanding of their condition and how it affects them. And here we are, 2022, almost the end of 2022, and it still hasn't happened. So the whole system is failing in many ways.
And I'll come to Frank McKillop on this. You're the first to mention self-directed support, so we'll come back to you.
Yeah, and I think, as I said, for enable self-directed support, I think has to be at the heart of the care model that is developed and delivered through a national care system. And delivers consistently right across Scotland at that standard. I think it's an excellent point. I think, as we see it, the sign above the door says the right thing, but when you go in, you're not actually getting what you expect. And I think that's certainly been the experience from a lot of people. The SDS legislation is in place. It's excellent legislation. It's fantastic. But the reality isn't being realised. And I think probably the first challenge there is with option one of SDS, where you get the direct payment and effectively you employ your own personal assistants. There are a lot of people who find that off-putting, frankly, because effectively they have to become small businesses. They have to be employing their own staff. They have to be going through all the processes and back office things that have to be done with that. So we know there's a lot of people who would like to have that level of choice and control around their support, who feel put off from it. And that's why Enable's model, the PA model that Enable developed, is essentially giving people the flexibility and control that they would have with option one, but we're doing it via option two. So it's Enable that is taking on all those responsibilities as the employer, and with everything that goes with that in terms of HR law and finance and payroll and everything else. But what we are clear about, we have a recruitment team that would advertise and everything, but it's the individual who is telling us what they're looking for, and they would then actually interview the candidates that are put forward, and they are choosing their own staff, and the experience that they have is from option one SDS. But we have developed that model so that people have that experience who might not perhaps have felt confident about doing that if they didn't have the support of a larger organisation with those resources to support that. So again, it's one of a number of models, but it is that sort of model that it's a solution that we developed as an organisation and as a charity, and reflective of what our members and people across Scotland were telling us they were looking for. And I think it's that sort of solution that we need to find, because again, from our perspective, self-directed support, the 2013 Act is great, and if the National Care Service, like I said, the sign above the door perhaps is the 2013 Act, and maybe it's the National Care Service Act is what can fill out the foundations that make that reality for everyone who wants to access SDS, and that's the core model for social care in Scotland.
Come to Dr. Nolan online's indicated she wants to come in, Emma.
Thank you, Convener. The independent review of adult social care by Derek Feely was very illustrative of the, really illustrated clearly the implementation gap. We've got, pockets of good practice across the country. And I've heard the quote from Osler that, let's not use a sledgehammer to crack a nut. But while we've got really good policy, it is such patchy delivery, and that's why we refer to the postcode lottery, because it's not just different local authorities, different partnerships where delivery can be in remote rural areas, for example, where the delivery of self-directed support can be really limit your choice and control. But it's also within local authority areas where so there'll be a good area where you can get access to good support, you can get your needs met, you're given the right information, and there'll be somewhere else where you don't even get that information. There's estimations from Public Health Scotland that suggested that 4 out of 5 people were involved in choosing and controlling their support via SDS options, but then that the Alliance and Self-Directed Support Scotland report, their research from 2020 demonstrated that about 50% of respondees had not had access to all the care support, self-directed support options. The 4 options of self-directed support hadn't been explained to them properly, they weren't given proper guidance, etc. And that's the very first hurdle of accessing social care support. If you don't have that information, you don't have choice and control. And that's the right that's written into the bill. Into the Act, sorry.
Thank you. Emma.
This morning I heard from 2 young people who were in receipt of self-directed support, but that wasn't the language they were using. They didn't know that that's what they were receiving. And so that the importance of people understanding what's being delivered or is that important, as long as we deliver the care that is necessary, or does it really matter about the language? But I was also interested, this might not be for the primary legislation though, but when we were in Dumfries, one of the care home owners said that people who are in a care home don't get self-directed support, but that's their home, and other folk get it in their home, so why don't care home residents get self-directed support? That might be a question for down the line, I suppose, but is that relevant to what should be in the primary legislation as far as really pinning down what self-directed support is all about?
And a reminder to those on our panel, if you want to come in on anything specifically, as you hear it been asked, if you're online, just use the chat box and put an R in the chat box, or if you're here in front of us, an indication, which Andy has just done helpfully. Thank you.
Yeah, so there's been a lot of reports over the years about how well or otherwise SCS is doing, and there's a number of difficulties that have been identified, and inconsistency is clearly one part of the picture. So option two hasn't been mentioned, and an awful lot of Frank mentioned it in terms of the enable model. And where SDS isn't working well, it's often because there's a low uptake of option two, which gives people a lot of control, but doesn't place as much responsibility on them as option one, a direct payment, would do. So part of the answer, I think, is to facilitate option two. And in terms of the health and social care partnerships, often the reason that they're not offering option two is just that it's too difficult, or there's a lack of resources. I don't mean too difficult to get their heads around. I just mean that the easiest course is either option one, where you're just handing over the budget and the responsibility to the individual or the family, or option three, where people, it's just the status quo, essentially. So part of the answer, a big part, I would suggest, would be to restructure or rework option two support enables model. I think that's excellent, which makes option two easier for everybody to manage and get their head around. What I would say, though, is that option three, the status quo, doesn't mean it's a bad service, which it's often taken to be. It's the majority option across most parts of Scotland. So it all depends. If people are saying, I would like the Health and Social Care Partnership to just deliver the support that I need, that could be a really positive option. And so the new National Care Service needs to look at the kind of basics of what a good service, how to offer a good service. And one of the key things that people have said that would make a huge difference is to take a no wrong door approach. So many folk have talked about how difficult it is to navigate the system, even to get into the system in the first place, whether it's at transitions or if you come into in later life as an adult, and to institute a no wrong door approach, where it doesn't matter who lifts the phone or who's on reception or wherever you first go in, that they then take it on themselves to do the heavy lifting and the navigating for that person, and to make sure that they then are seen by the right person, assessed appropriately, and are given all the support that they are entitled to. That would be a major improvement. Now, I don't know whether that goes into secondary legislation or not, but it's one of the biggest improvements that we could make.
We'll bring in Dr. Gould, and then I have to go to Paul, if that's okay, Emma. Dr. Gould.
Thank you, convener. One thing I would like to point out is in remote rural areas, you know, there's a tendency for everybody to know everybody's business, and quite a few people want to know everybody's business. And for a lot of disabled people, they tell us that they really do believe that SDS option one is their best option. And when we ask them why, the majority seem to believe that this was because they could then keep from the NHS or anybody else the name of their carers, which meant that when they were in hospital or ill or needed changes in their care assessment, that their carer wasn't the one, instead of them themselves, that was contacted, because they could privately keep their name out of things. And yet they're still telling us they're constantly in hospital
being demanded of, like, tell us who the name of your carers are, and we'll contact them and we'll sort out you going home, when that's not person-centred by any means. And that is one distinct advantage that people tell us locally in remote rural areas, option one, to actually employ their carer direct, although it takes extra time and it's really difficult in many ways for them, is one reason why they do it, which is why I'm concerned also about the who sees your records and things. I mean, somebody came to us recently and said, well, I was raped in my early 20s. I wasn't able to have children, though I tried very hard. It's all in my medical records. I don't want somebody bringing that up when somebody comes to do a social care assessment. I don't even want them knowing about it. I don't want them knowing about my post-traumatic stress disorder and stuff. It's these sort of things that, you know, once it gets out to one person, it can get out throughout the whole of a small community and people are treated differently. And that's where I really don't think, when you're an urban dweller, as I have been in for many decades before, there is a huge difference between going into a supermarket, going to a checkout, and being anonymous to the checkout operator. It doesn't happen in a remote rural area. Everybody knows who you are and everybody knows most of your history that has been made public. So, I mean, I cannot stress enough how important SDS is for a lot of people, for that reason alone, to keep their business to themselves.
Paul.
Thank you very much, convener. I suppose I'm interested in terms of transitions from childhood into adulthood and from the services that lie therein. There have obviously been previous private members' bills, and there are bills in front of the Parliament just now that relate to a lot of this. You know, is the sense that it might have been better to try and capture some of those elements in those bills into this legislation, and do you think there's opportunity to do that? And maybe, you know, I think Frank and Andy have been close to some of the work on those bills, so just keen to get that sense, first of all.
Shall I kick off? General point, first of all, that as well as the transitions bill, there's a number of other pieces of legislation going through, and I would just make the point that it's really important that these different bits of legislation are aligned and support each other and don't duplicate. As there are several points where that could easily happen. For example, there's the proposal to have a social care commissioner in this legislation, but there's also other proposals to have a learning disability, autism, neurodiversity commissioner, or perhaps a disability commissioner, and I'm just not sure how much current alignment there is in the different teams all trying to put this difficult, complex legislation. I'm not minimising the task, but just that's really really important. And Paula, sorry, I've forgotten the specific question that you asked.
I think is it important to try and pull some of the threads of those things together? Is there an opportunity in the National Care Service Bill, do you think, to do that? Mm. Because obviously, this is a government bill, and we wouldn't want to lose sight of some of those sorts of elements that I think are broadly supported by certainly the learning disability sector and others.
Yeah. So I think the Human Rights Bill, which should incorporate the UNCRPD, which Dr. Gove mentioned, I think that would lay out the framework for the human rights approach, which is legislated for here. That would give the detail of that. In terms of transitions, I think what's laid out in the transitions bill should just, you know, belongs in the transitions bill. You know, and I don't think there's anything that should be transported over here. I think just keep an eye. Obviously, there's in terms of function, there's a lot that of potential overlap, and the oversight that's mentioned in the transitions bill in terms of the national strategy, I think could be really helpful, and the national transition strategy and then the national care strategies obviously need to align.
Yeah, I think an important element of the transitions crossover perhaps is whether it is going to be the intention longer term to include children's services within the National Care Service. I think that is, you know, if that is going to come to pass, I know that's something that will be separately consulted on with the sector, the children's services sector. I think that would perhaps make sense to have transitions as part of the National Care Service Bill to reflect that. I think at the present time, I probably agree with Andy that Transitions Bill, as it stands, and will hopefully enjoy support across the Parliament. It's very much something we've supported since it was originally proposed in the previous Parliament. I think that is perhaps the right place for that just now, while there's that uncertainty about whether children's services will be part of the NCS. But I think it's certainly that crossover, I think, is important, and I think certainly to ensure that we are enshrining those rights, those transitions from school pupils towards potentially adult social care services as they leave school and potentially leave home and look to use their right to have a home of their own and to independent living. I think it is very important that we capture that within the National Care Service Bill. So I do think it's certainly something that is worth looking at, but I do think the Transitions Bill as a separate piece of legislation still has a great deal of value.
Okay. I'm going to bring in Pauline Nolan, wants to come in.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, Inclusion Scotland and Camp Hill Scotland led on promoting the idea of a national care service and getting an MSP to sponsor it. And we wrote the policy memorandum. So we are completely supportive of the Transitions Bill. And this is because over the years, we've been told so many times that young people, particularly going through transitions 16 to 18 and then to adulthood, and the support and the and all the social work and everything like that just drops off, ends. In fact, it's just happened to a family member today who's autistic and turned 18. And my sister, this is in England anyway, but my sister had the phone call today and phoned me up in tears because the social worker's just told her on the phone that all his support has been dropped because he's 18 and he's got some money in the bank. So no support to get him PA support or to travel independently and things like that. That's all gone. This has been a constant story over the years. The Transitions Bill will bring in that right to have a transitions, you know, that things, a plan, transitions plan, and discussions, ongoing discussions with the right people throughout the transition. But PLPP members did agree that children's social work and being involved in the NCS would help with those transitions. I think that was the proposal, why it was proposed to be in the NCS, because those services would then be delivered all under one roof. And at the moment, there's absolutely no continuity. So I really believe that there should be, if children's services are going to be in the National Care Service, then that needs to be taken alongside the Transitions Bill when it becomes Act.
Thank you. Paul?
I suppose that follows on the point that Frank McKillop made just around that question of social work. So I think there is a debate, it's fair to say, we've heard evidence on both sides of the argument about social work and children's services going in or out of the scope. But I suppose, do you think it's important that social work as a profession stays together, wherever it, you know, sort of wherever the end point is, because of the points that have been made around transitions?
Yep, so I do think there's a value in that, certainly. And I think, certainly from an ABLE's perspective, our priority is in terms of the Feeley Review recommendations being realised around adult social care. But I think, certainly, the value that social work, the value of social work as a profession, I think, is very important, and to ensure that that is kept together and that there is recognition for the value that that delivers to people and the importance that that has in terms of both children's services and adult social care services, to ensure that people are actually having access to the options around self-directed support and the support that they need. I think there's definitely a value in that, but again, our priority very much is to ensure that the Feeley recommendations around adult social care are fulfilled.
Thank you. I'm going to hand back to Emma Harper, who wants to pick up on care records.
Yep. Thanks very much, convener. Just picking up on what Dr. Gold said about rural areas and everybody knowing your business in a rural area. I cover South Scotland region and it's very rural, and I think you're right, folk know what you're up to before you even know what you're up to sometimes in rural areas. So, and I think we've probably got other members that are very aware of how rural healthcare does kind of get around the town or the village that we're with. So when, in terms of discussing like digital care records or a way of sharing information so that certain stories are allowed to be repeated and other stories remain buried, if that's the choice, what would you think? I'll go to Dr. Gold first, if that's okay or good. What are your fears of like the care record, and what would you hope to see as something that would be deliverable to help improve care on the ground?
Well, personally, I would like to see a variety of options of how records are held and accessed, but also a full log of what has been accessed and by whom. Because for some people, it's easier, instead of them constantly having to repeat themselves to staff, it's easier for them to have a certain portion of what they want them to know available to them and accessible by them, rather than having to constantly repeat information. But it's difficult because you also have, you know, what I would term that childhood game Chinese whispers, where, you know, the more people get told something and pass it on to someone else, the more it changes and grows legs and becomes something far from the truth. And I think there needs to be a lot more respect in by the people who hold this sort of information as to what use it's put to, what they think they have access to. Because let me just say that I have come across people who have used it to their own advantage to win an argument professionally rather than actually to show any real care for the person it was about. I think a lot more has to be looked into it, because I think we are tending to go to a very digital age and put all our one basket of eggs in the electricity supply thing. And even in a remote rural area, I mean, I've been to hospitals where they've said, oh, the computer system's gone down, oh, we can't access your records, oh, we don't know, you know, what you've had before now and stuff. And I mean, that's sort of not the point at which you want nobody to be able to access your records if it's an important thing.
Emma?
So I know that again, on the face of the bill, the digital care record that is accessible and secure and safe is absolutely maybe what we need to be thinking about. And I think you're right about having choice and traceability and knowing who's accessed records and things like that as well. For me, coming from a nursing background where, you know, we're operating on somebody and you want to know what's happened in the past, previous surgeries, things like that, it is really handy to have a record where we can look for safety reasons as well. Also, there are, like, third sector doesn't have access to the records or a record. Is that something that you would support? Is that all round who is looking after this person, self-directed support, whatever, is it necessary that the right people have access to the record?
That's a really important question, and I think the key thing that people with learning disabilities have told us is that they need to have control over it, rather than just saying ahead on principle these people should and these people shouldn't have access, or this is the amount of access these folks should have and that's the amount of access. This complex system that Dr. Gold described has to be co-designed so that people who are going to benefit from it or be harmed by it own it. So it, that might sound like a fudge, but it's really not. I think it's so important, and it would be so easy because it's technically very complex to design this system, to leave it to the technocrats. But I think it's so important that there's a co-design process going on there. I just wanted to remember what happened with GERFEC and the difficulties there with data sharing. Is really important not to make that mistake again. So something that's co-designed, and also to think about the scope of it, because it links with support planning. To what extent does the support planning link with the data record, and then how is all that going to be afforded? Because some health and social care partnerships at the moment have two IT systems working, one for health, one for social care, and for an effective data sharing system to work, it's got to be using ideally one system, or certainly two compatible systems, and that just isn't the case just now. So we're talking about a massive investment, which I don't think has been put into the financial memorandum.
You want to pick up on something that Andy said before I go to? We've got Dr. Nolan wants to come in, and Dr. Gould, so if you ask her. Yeah.
Food Train, or Meals and Wheels equivalent, deliver to folks' homes, and may pick up on an increase in memory loss, for instance, which might then trigger a need for an assessment or more care or something like that. So as part of the co-design process, the likes of Food Train or Meals and Wheels equivalent should be involved, so that they can either feed into the report, not necessarily have access to the report. So again, that's about the ongoing assessment. Is that something that we should be thinking about in the co-design as we move forward?
I think that's a great idea and a great example, but I don't think I should be the one making the say-so. I think those questions and the question that you posed about the rest of the third sector, who have a lot of the day-to-day contact with people, the extent to which they have access to either input or read, get access to, has to be people that use social care that make those decisions. But I think that's a really good example. And I remember someone talking who lived in Skye, saying that she helped to run lunch clubs, and that was a brilliant early warning system, because if someone didn't turn up to the weekly lunch club for a couple of weeks in a row, you'd start to get there. That would be a red flag, and time to look into that. So, yeah.
I'm going to bring in Dr. Nolan first.
Just to really reiterate there what my colleague just said. It's really important that it's down to personal preference, and that also it's all co-designed. That would be a really good idea to bring into the co-design. The only additional thing that I wanted to add is that the control over the information that is gathered, and you could look towards the Scottish Government's consultation on the health and social care data strategy, which was done recently, and the PLPP gave lots and lots and lots of input to how that strategy should be. They had lots to say, but really importantly is, although not having to repeat your story over and over again can potentially be liberating, if that is information, confidential information, is recorded wrongly, you should have an opportunity to be able to feed that back, and for that information to be changed in accordance to what you said, rather than it just being shared with other people and other service providers, and the wrong information keeps coming back to you. That's all I wanted to add. I agree with everything that's been said already. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Nolan. I'll go to Dr. Gould.
Thank you. I just wanted to reiterate what Pauline has just said. It's when something's found to have been recorded incorrectly in records, that's where the major difficulty is, getting that corrected. And it can happen quite frequently. If somebody has a condition which changes over time, then those changes may not be recorded correctly or updated everywhere. And that can cause actually major issues, like people turning up in hospital as inpatients and not getting a single meal whilst they're in hospital, or people not understanding their care needs in terms of food intake and things. There has to be a way of correcting wrong information. And as someone who has multiple times had it recorded in my medical notes and my occupational therapy notes that I have had several surgeries to both ankles, and I've never had surgery to an ankle in my life, I'd really welcome some way of changing it, amongst others.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move on to discussion on co-design and sequencing of that, led by Paul Kane. Paul.
Thank you very much, convener. You know, I suppose co-design is at the heart of the approach to the bill, and the government are keen to co-design once we have the framework legislation passed. But I suppose my initial question is, you know, do you feel there should have been more co-design in advance of the bill coming to this legislative process? And I suppose maybe going back to the kind of first question we had at the head of the session, which is what is missing from the bill that people have through co-design processes advocated should be on the face of the bill?
I'll go to Frank first of all on that.
Thanks.
Yes, I do think that there's, again, as many respondents to the consultation had noted, the bill is a framework bill. I think we do feel there's a lot of detail behind that we would like to see. And I think there is always a feeling that some more co-design before this stage would have been a good thing. But I also sort of take the point that perhaps, especially in the third sector, we always call for more co-design, and there is a point where you just got to go on with things. And I just sort of appreciate that as well. I think the Feely review itself, going back, you know, I think it's more than 2 years since the Feely review began. There was a lot of sector input at that point. I think there was quite a lot of co-design, if we call it that. There was certainly a great deal of consultation. I think many across the sector feel that a lot of work was done at that stage to build the Feely recommendations. So I think where those have been pulled through into the National Care Service Bill, I think we would be satisfied that there's been a good deal of consultation with the sector has happened to get to that point. But certainly I think, you know, co-design is something that is important to us. Obviously, as a charity that represents many people with a learning disability, they're very keen to be involved. Many of them are involved in the various panels that are involved in supporting the design of what the National Care Service is going to look like. And I'm also very conscious that I think it was 1,291 responses to the government consultation. So there's a lot of people have views on this, but not always 100% in agreement. So there is always a danger that co-design becomes a sort of excuse to hold things up. I think that would be our concern there. There's a lot of practice in the sector that is effective that we need to learn from. So I think alongside, you know, I think it's important that co-design is a genuinely productive process, that we are bringing in views, that we are bringing in experiences, and those experiences of social care are informing how we design the bill, or rather design the National Care Service itself off the back of the bill. But I think there is also that importance of learning from what already works and learning from what is effective in the sector. And I think, you know, sort of our biggest call would be that, you know, what we currently have for social care in Scotland isn't working. So we do need to change this, and urgent action is required. So certainly we do feel, you know, things are never perfect, there's always imperfections, and probably more co-design earlier would have been preferable, but we certainly wouldn't want things to be held up on that basis, and the ongoing co-design is certainly something that we would support to try and make sure that we are definitely getting this right, but we do need reform, we need reform to happen.
Thank you. Dr. Nolan would like to come in.
That some of the co-design has already started, but we're not sure which. We're not sure what's happened to the design school, which was supposed to be training people in what co-design is. We're still a bit unclear on the difference between co-design and co-production, which is what we do. Apart from, I would say that co-production, you're probably not starting from a blank sheet, but co-design, you should be. And really, from our point of view, if this bill had been co-designed, so, you know, a lot of it was done through consultation, but if co-design was done, for example, on the local care board, yes, a lot of this needs to be co-designed and the detail needs to be added. But the wording wouldn't say the board must seek views on a draft of the plan. It would say the board would co-design the draft of the plan. It would say, you know, having, you know, that, and then they would, it wouldn't say the wider community, which could include anybody who has no interest in social care support. It would say they would go to supported people, their families, their supporters and unpaid carers. And in the case of a special care board, it should say disabled people, including mental health survivors and their organisations, families, supporters, unpaid carers and their organisations. So if that co-design had been done properly, it would have been more specific and talking about co-design being embedded through the processes of governance and not just consultation. And that's really, really important. If you're talking about co-designing the system, the ongoing co-design needs to be in there. It needs to be in the monitoring, the evaluation through every part of the system and not just right from the start. It's important right from the start, but it has to be ongoing as well.
Thank you. Paul.
Thank you, convener. I suppose following on from that, there's a commonality about co-design being clearly part of this process. I wonder if Andy might want to comment on how people who have disabilities, people who have learning disabilities particularly, will be. What's your vision for them being involved in that co-design, and how do we ensure that they are involved in that co-design?
So first, can I say that I really commend the vision and the commitment to co-design. I think that's been so refreshing. The commitment's been there right from the start. I would echo what some people said, that it didn't. A lot happened before the co-design actually kicked in, and that's a little bit regrettable. However, the commitment to it, which is really visible and tangible now, is great. In terms of people with learning disabilities being involved, I think there's a little way to go, but again, there's a commitment to learning how to do it better. So for example, small example, but meetings with stakeholders have started to be done by Zoom, which had been, you know, impossible apparently earlier on, but now they're folk have made the commitment. They've realised that Zoom's a more accessible platform than Teams for a lot of people, and so that change has been made, and that's great. What I would say is that the model of the lived experience panels, which have been implemented, we've got some concerns that's about the accessibility of that process. Folk in the National Care Service team point to the success of the Social Security lived experience panels, which they've borrowed the model from. But actually, people with learning disabilities struggled to get involved effectively in that process as well. So there's a lot of learning still to be done with that. There's a lot of different, you know, if you break it down, there's a lot of different points where the inaccessibility can come right from joining or applying to join the panel. I help support someone to join, because although there's a phone number which you could phone if you wanted support, they didn't have the confidence to do that. They didn't know who they were going to be phoning, who's going to be answering the phone, and that was enough just to make it too difficult. So I think it's a question of coming back to folk always and saying, is this working for you? How can we improve it? A lot of it's just to do with accessible information and gaining people's trust. And that's not just easy read, having a range of formats that are available to people. But there is forward motion there, which I'm very pleased about. And the second part of your question about going forward, I would just echo what some other people have said about the need to continue the co-design ethos after the National Care Service is in place. So, for example, the 3-year National Care Service strategies should be co-designed as well. And at the moment, there's nothing that suggests they're going to be. So I think that needs to be there as a commitment to an ongoing commitment to co-design, and then as each thing comes up to be implementing it. Sorry, that ended up a bit of a waffle. Sorry.
I'm going to bring in Runa Wilder, and then Paul, if you have another question, I'll come back to you, but if not, I'll go to Tess White. I'll bring in Runa.
Thank you, Convener. It was to raise a point around the independent advocacy that we would like to see in the face of the bill to include collective advocacy and how important that would be for co-design. Including a right to collective advocacy would be incredibly useful, particularly if the collective advocacy groups were able to refer systemic human rights concerns to an independent complaints body. Having collective advocacy groups that are autonomous from the system is a really useful way to make sure that people can highlight their ongoing concerns. And this would be important from the point of view of co-designing at the start, but as colleagues have mentioned, making sure that gathering people's views on an ongoing basis, because everything is not going to be perfect from the start, would be really important. And having independent advocacy models in there that support the principles of the bill would be a very useful way to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Rona. Can I go to Tess White for a question?
Thank you, Convener. My question's to Andy Miller, if I may. So, Andy, the SCLD have said that some areas of the bill are within the scope of co-design, whilst others are not. So in your opinion, what areas do you feel are not subject to co-design? Thank you.
I'm sorry, if I actually wrote that in our response, it was the opposite of what I meant. what I meant to say was that in the original paper and in the language of the bill, there were certain areas which would be where they would bring co-design methodology to bear. For example, the development of the charter, realizing rights and responsibilities, but they were specific areas. And the point that we wanted to make, obviously made it very badly, was that we hoped that those would not be the delineated areas where co-design applied, and that it should be co-design more broadly. And the other point beside that was that it felt like it was one side that had decided which areas were to be amenable to co-design and which areas weren't, and it wasn't the side that included people with learning disabilities. So there was a slight kind of objection to that. So I'm sorry if that came across wrongly.
Yeah, it may have been me interpreting, so that's really helpful. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, and final set of questions from Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. I would like to go back to something that Dr. Gold said at the beginning of the meeting about issues being experienced by disabled people and those in remote and rural areas. How can we get the co-design process more inclusive to make sure that the issues of the past are not carried forward into the National Care Service? And it's to Dr. Gold.
Thank you. I think the issues in remote rural areas are far bigger than just the National Care Service. We've been talking about people being included in their communities. Well, their communities need to be accessible to them. When somebody who drives a 6 meter long wheelchair accessible vehicle that requires an additional 4 meters out of traffic, moving traffic at the rear for them to get in and out of, and it takes a lot of money to fuel, yet they need to pay in smaller shops who don't have card machines, who are like one single person shops in their community, then they need cash to do that, because they can't use cards. They also need cash to buy their fuel, but they have to travel sometimes over 50 miles to the nearest place because they can't use an ATM because they are not being designed as being accessible to them. They can't get into their post office because it's not accessible to them. They can't use a toilet in their brand new All Singing, All Dancing hospital because it's not accessible to them, because their needs were never taken into account in the first place. Then I think we have a huge problem in remote rural Scotland in particular, but in other parts of Scotland as well. And it doesn't just apply to social care. I think it's a huge problem, and it's a huge problem that's not going to go away until it's addressed nationally for everything that provides a service, because there is no way that a disabled person should be not only, first of all, penalised financially because they're disabled, but also penalised because their community doesn't seem to care enough to follow the law, and the onus is on the disabled individual to first of all be discriminated against and then be able to take a case. It's very difficult to find somebody to take a case, and if you lose in a legal technicality and you lose the roof over your head, what is the point? But we're already penalised if you need adaptations in your home. Adaptations and aids are not really something that are in the National Care Service Bill, but I strongly believe they should be, because they link to you being freely able to do things yourself as independently as possible. But if you have to save up to have so many aids or adaptations in your home, and as a result of that, you lose your access to SDS because you've built up the savings, so you lose it, then you have to pay the savings. So you can never win if you're disabled. You can absolutely never win. It's as simple as that. Until people actually see disabled people as equal members of society who have a right to be treated equally, which does not happen in Scotland, then nothing's going to change. And it's very sad to have to say that and to represent people who say that to me all the time.
Could I just follow up, Dr. Gould, and ask you, and we totally appreciate everything that you've just said there, in terms of the rest of the people. In terms of the co-design process that the government wants to take forward, so that the views of people like yourself in rural areas is heard, What would be your plea to them as part of the accessibility for you taking part on the co-design process?
Something personal. So, would you be happy to pass on a message?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So, were you aware that?
Sorry, can I come back to you?
I've
got somebody on the other line, so, and on another line, and then I'll come back to you in a bit. An hour.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So
I mean, a minute.
I don't know where that's coming from.
For next Monday.
All right, okay.
All right. We'll see if you can...
I can't speak to her.
Well, maybe what we'll maybe do is we'll maybe write to Dr. Gould and we'll get that question specifically answered, because I think it's an important question that Evelyn has asked about the co-design process, and to get that feedback actually might be really, really helpful. So what we'll do is, we've run out of time anyway, what we'll do is we'll follow up, the committee can follow up with Dr. Gould, because obviously somebody's needing their attention at the moment, and I don't really want to disrupt that at all. We'll write to Dr. Gould and get her specific feedback, but also I think I'd like to put that out to everybody, because I think that's part of what we might want to feedback in our report about the accessibility issues that there might be for that co-design process, both in terms of time, capacity, funding, support, and also making sure that lots of various people have the opportunity to input into that co-design process. Oh, Dr. Nolan, I'll bring you in before we wind up then.
Yeah, I think it was Andy that talked about the use of Zoom. That's probably going to be better for people in remote rural areas for accessibility, but it's going to help for people who can't travel to Central Belt things, and I'm aware that this is being used. The trouble is as mentioned earlier, that a lot of disabled people are excluded from digital engagement, and so there needs to be consideration of doing in-person co-design, perhaps in some of these remote rural areas where there's probably going to be even more barriers, and going and doing kind of, you know, going to very specific localities, not just one region, or somewhere where everybody can easily access. So you'd have to go to Skye as well as going to Inverness, because the Highlands are so huge. And similarly, you know, numerous places in the Scottish borders, because the transport network doesn't connect necessarily. But you know, then it also, you need to consider the impacts of different things, such as different aspects on remote rural areas. So having a charter, having a national advocacy service or local advocacy services, etc. So it goes through right through the whole co-design of these aspects of the bill. And then how it impacts on different people with different impairments, people with different social care support needs. There's a lot of consideration that needs to be brought in to co-design, and I can appreciate how hard it's going to be, because social care support is incredibly complex, the current delivery of it. And I should have said at the start, by the way, that eligibility criteria hasn't been addressed in the bill, and how people are going to have their needs met hasn't been addressed at all in the bill, and that's going to be really important going forward as well. What's going to replace eligibility criteria?
Yeah, thank you.
It was mentioned in the previous panel as well, and it's been mentioned by a few people. We've got Dr. Gould back. The last word to you, Dr. Gould, before we wind up.
Sorry, could somebody remind me what the question was?
The question was that I think I wanted to, I mean, given all the wider concerns you've got, and we totally appreciate those, that we would be keen to know what the message would be to the government as they start their co-design process after the passing of this bill, that would help somebody in remote and rural areas to be involved in that co-design. What practically could they do?
Well, involve them in whatever way they feel they need to be involved in whatever method. And I mean, that could be, you know, one thing is that a lot of people have been using Microsoft Teams for meetings, and disabled people actually find that really difficult to use. They find Zoom much easier. I have personally found this software really challenging for me because of my disability. To find out what people's needs are in terms of communication and planned communication and things. But I mean, I have, I think, shocked people, researchers and various civil servants that I've spoken to over the last year and a half, being told, oh, well, this is how the journey or the pathway from this to social care works. And this only takes about 2 weeks. And we've actually had sort of stop laughing and saying, actually, that would take over 2 years here. There needs to be like a complete understanding, which is why I actually suggested that after the first National Care Service Forum took place in Perth, that they might like to move it to Skye next year and then see what it's like when you're claiming that people should be using mobile phones in an area where they don't have mobile phone signal. They don't have a whole IT department behind them if you're asking individuals or small charities to be involved. Things are just so different, and there has to be some degree of understanding from the decision makers and the researchers of how different it is, because not everybody here has broadband. They don't even have access to broadband if they want it. And there is an assumption that the whole of Scotland, you know, is connectable easily digitally. I mean, we have disabled people and elderly people who only use mobile phones with large buttons. They can only receive a text or a phone call, or make it write a text or a phone call. Not everybody is all singing, all dancing like elsewhere. And it's important these people feel involved, because when people don't even understand what it's like for them here, then they don't plan for that or allow for that. And so it really is important that we are discussing. I mean, I was at a meeting recently where somebody said, oh, it's quite simple. You just go to your local library And somebody in Shetland said, oh, well, for that, then for me, that's two ferry rides and half an hour's drive as well. And the person who'd said, just go to your local library, couldn't believe the distances involved. There are huge distances involved. And it means that people get left out. And I would ask that you do as much as possible to feedback that these people are not left out, because they are the ones that end up being excluded in the whole National Care Service.
Thank you. Thank you. And a good note to end on. So that is, that brings our formal meeting to a close. At our next meeting, the committee will continue our scrutiny of the National Care Service Scotland Bill with a further two evidence sessions focusing on related services, public protection, older people and Anne's Law. And can I thank everyone that's joined us in Glasgow today, everyone that's been involved in the formal meeting, and to Quarriers for hosting us, and also to everyone that we met this morning in the centre of Glasgow for their time this morning. It's been hugely helpful, and I think this type of outreach and going out to different places in Scotland as much as possible can only help make a better scrutiny process. So thank you to you all for helping us out in that regard. Thank you.